right. Hello, and welcome back to the third and final installment for now of Canuck as a Slur, which is sort of the third installment of our Don Cherry story. So with me, again, is Jules and Lucas.
The other guy.
It's been a marathon. Jules and Lucas from Australia.
How late is it there for you?
I mean, it's 10:51, but that's not late for me. So
okay,
I don't know.
Every now and then I get messages from Kelly, and it's just like it must be like 4 a.m. there, mate.
Well, that's probably for me working nights or whatever. But yeah,
gotcha. All
right, I don't know. My body wants to be unhealthy. Speaking of unhealthy, we've been talking about the 7th greatest Canadian, Don Cherry. And
you keep reminding me of this. Yeah. I'm just like, oh, good Lord.
Yeah. I feel like he'd be voted lower now, but yeah. What a.
Yeah, I feel like 2004, when the vote happened, was before most of this really spicy stuff.
Yeah. It's also before, like, I don't know, we could wax on about the internet, but like, it is easier to get information now, for better or for worse. And like, I will say, like, I grew up watching hockey. I had this concept of Don Cherry as like the hockey guy on TV forever. And most of this stuff I hadn't seen before, probably half of the stuff I hadn't seen before I started digging into it. And it's easy to find because you can find all these old archive news articles. You can find clips on YouTube. You can find all this. So like, by trying to do a little research, I started this out being like, yeah, he was a very ridiculous TV clown who kind of just got more and more unhinged with his outlandish statements. And like, you know, like, but I was a Don Cherry apologist into like probably around the time of those like Coach's Corner transcribed videos we watched, where it was like, yeah, you know what? Like, he's just like your kind of vaguely racist uncle. It's like, or your grandpa. Like, he's gonna just like let him kind of just. No one really cares. All sports analysis is stupid. He's your racist grandpa. Just like, progress is made one grave at a time. Who cares? Like, we don't need to take him off TV. And that was kind of like my memory of it when I started working on this. I was like, oh, I'm gonna show him like these ridiculous, outlandish suits and all this stuff. And only through like really digging into it was I just shocked by how much stuff there was and stuff I hadn't seen. So like, I think part of that kind of change in perception is like facilitated by how much easier it is to like lay it out all end to end, which makes it look so much worse than your like memory of. It's because it's also worth noting that like, again, this is somebody who spoke like a handful of minutes every week. You could totally tune it out. I didn't really sit through to like pay that much attention during intermissions. For every minute of like weird Atlanta stuff we're seeing, you had hours and hours and hours of just like very garden variety hockey analysis or like stuff that just wouldn't really trip anyone's sensors that much.
Yeah.
So like he's been so. There's so much of this that, right, it takes decades to really, like, accrue this kind of rap sheet.
And that's pretty much what happened to, like, going back to Australian Gothic with Hey Hey It's Saturday. Like, I still, you know, I found, while researching that episode, found very complimentary articles or, like, fond remembrances of Hey Hey It's Saturday as as 2016. And it was, you know, after that everyone remembered, you know, remembered, you know, the many, many horrible things that show did. And everyone was just like, oh, actually, yeah, like you've said, laying out all the facts and looking at everything allows you to reassess it. So no, that's a, yeah, it's interesting. That's that point in history that everyone's just like, actually, the thing I liked was had a lot of problems.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. And I mean, it's like multi-layered too, because I, you know, being listening to more Australian podcasts than, you know, a normal foreign person should. Like
more than
I
a
remember,
normal person should.
Yeah. Like than a normal. Yeah. I remember like one of the things that you talked about on Hey Hey It's Saturday was how they were pretty shitty towards Kamal, where was Kamal from? Was he from,
he was a musician and, you know, a pretty big deal.
Like wait, was he, this, sorry, this has been a long time. Was he like just an Australian born like ethnic minority, or was he from another country?
I believe he was born in Malaysia, spent a decent amount of his life there, but like worked in Australia. Yeah. So, you know, Malaysian Australian, I think.
Right. So like you could see him kind of getting like shit on and like racially profiled, but like this has been coming up like online now, where he's like been like publicly what's the bad one, the no vote on the Indigenous Voice in Parliament.
Yeah.
So it's like you know, give anyone long enough, they just become a dickhead themselves.
Yeah, there's a leftist argument against the no vote coming from some parts of the Indigenous community, but that is not the one he's making.
Right.
Oh, okay.
To be very clear on that.
And yeah. What we were just looking at the end of part two was a guy named Max Pacioretty getting his head smoked off his body. But like he had a rap sheet himself, right? Like he's kind of a notorious dickhead. And so like there's just like there's layers to this intersectionality to like, I don't know. I feel like a more articulate person would make a really interesting point about this, but but it's just easy to kind of like look at these things through different lenses, because there's also all these fawning articles on Don Cherry. And like, if you go to YouTube and you watch most of the clips that we put in, YouTube has its bent, obviously, or the YouTube commenters have their bent. But like, there's so many people that are so like, he's telling it like it is. It's so good. Like, we need more of this. Like, it's alive and well. So part three, how are you feeling so far about, you know, at this point compared to the beginning, about like Canada, Canadians, sports, hockey?
Once upon a time, I saw a history presentation by Twitter user Asfas, who was talking about various things about Australia, and she started it with the statement, "Australia sucks because Britain sucks," and I think that also applies to Canada. I'm just like, Canada sucks because Britain sucks. It's sort of like, it feels like talking to a sibling who maybe you didn't grow up with and realizing you have so many of the same flaws.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And understanding exactly where they come from.
And this is probably navel-gazing for another day, but like, why does Britain suck? Who colonized them 2,000 years ago?
A bunch of
dickheads who, like, you know, there were people indigenous to those islands that were colonized and had their culture erased. And
they're also hilariously really stoked about it. Like, they're so happy about the Roman conquest, and then they're also really happy about the Norman conquest.
Interesting.
Like, yeah. Yeah.
But people also adopt, like, people do adopt into colonial stuff. Like,
that's true.
Many places that have been colonized, and I always find, like, it's not my place to tell people, but it always feels uncomfortable when, like, those people from those places are, like, really Christian. And I'm like,
yeah,
like, that was imported, like, that, anyway.
I get that same discomfort in, like, noticing that. It's just like, oh, okay, you're really into this? Like, okay. But again, like, who am I to fucking say? Like,
Part three is pretty much entirely dedicated to xenophobia, but for a little, you were asking about like, was he married? All right. I'm going to read from this ESPN article. It says, along the way, Cherry met a young woman named Rosemary Madeline Martini, then 17 in Hershey, Pennsylvania. On their first date, Cherry took Rose to one of his hockey games. True to form, he was involved in a bloody fight. Rose always said her father thought Canadian hockey players were the most uncivilized people, and Cherry did little to dissuade him from this point of view. Yet Cherry also was capable of an uncharacteristic sensitivity, especially when it came to how much his love for hockey cost his family. In a tribute to his late wife for the Rose Cherry Home, a hospice for children in Milton, Ontario, Cherry writes, "If you believe it, Rose packed and moved 53 times. The minor career is a tough life for families. One bedroom, his daughter, Cindy, slept on a mattress on the floor and bathed in the kitchen sink. Toilets were in the cellar with cold air blowing through holes in the walls. So cold you had to have blankets around you when you had to go. It was not pretty. In Springfield, come back to our apartment after game on the road. Rose curled up in bed, the place alive with mice and rats. The point I'm trying to make is Rose Cherry's Home for Kids is named after a person who never quit. And what he really meant, of course, is that Rose never quit on him. So again, wife guy.
Okay.
So there's another mention from the same article. He shared both his passion and the backlash it often provoked with his childhood sweetheart, Rose, until 1997 when she died after a battle with cancer. For a time, hockey was all he had left, and in the harsh light of reality, Cherry might admit his life felt surprisingly empty. Is a quote from him. I was that guy standing in the kitchen, eating beans out of a can and washing the spoon in the sink. He says of his life as a widower. I knew a lot of people, but I had nobody to hang around with. I had a lot of acquaintances. I don't know why I don't have many friends. My life is very narrow, he acknowledges with the barest hint of a catch in his voice. That's not too good.
Huh.
Yeah.
That's a spark of self-awareness. Unfortunately, as eloquent as that sounded, I'm just imagining, like, present a version of him. It's like, I was sitting in bins of the sink. I felt empty.
Like, it's humanizing, but it's also a bit of schadenfreude during some of the worst parts here.
Yeah, it's just like, oh, okay, you're a fucking husk. You've maybe invested too much of your life into this game. Like, ooh.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Also, that statistic about, like, how much men rely on their wives for, like, their sole social support, and that sometimes the wife is like the key to their entire social life, and if their wife passes sort of young like that, like a while before they do, they just have nothing. They have no other contacts. They've got like no other like close intimate friends.
Mm-hmm.
Probably like one of the few people they can really confide in as well, like, you know, someone you can like, oh, you know, be vulnerable in front of, particularly as a dude of that generation. To lose that would be, would make you feel like a bit of a fucking husk.
Mm. Yeah.
Sorry, Kelly, I cut you off there.
No, it's a good point. And like, again, it's another discussion you could just talk for an hour about. It's like, it's such a good mirror for many, many people you just meet in everyday life. And I think also like, it's also reflected in like, in that same article, I didn't quote this part, but he talks about like, oh, I don't take vacations, I don't do this. Like, your whole life is like wife and job. And I've had conversations with people like this recently too, where like there's people who are like, oh, I retired and went back to work because I was just so bored. And like all of my friends who retired died. And that's why I keep working, because like, it's a similar type of person who has such a narrow world. He even said himself is a narrow world. Like, it's a very narrow world when your only socialization is your wife. It's a very narrow life when your only like hobby is work.
Yeah.
And I mean, he has a job people would kill for, but like, it's still like, it just doesn't have anything outside of work. Like, he didn't hit 65 and go, cool, I'm done.
There's a wonderful bit in the show Get Kraken, which, you know, we talked about that in the Deadlock episode. Where you probably remember, Jules, the episode of Get Kraken with like the Karl Stefanovic XP, like, you know, male morning TV presenters, where they throw to like a footy show and the host is this like lad dickhead and he's talking to an old football player and the football player just gets like really honest and is just like, oh, toxic masculinity has destroyed my life.
Yeah.
He's talking about all the horrible shit that's happened to him and the footy host is like, oh yeah, mate, it's pretty good. I bet you did this. So this is giving me whiffs of that. It's just like, wow, I did not expect a level of self-awareness from this like shouty dickhead. But this was also like before he got really, really bad. So he clearly like had this moment of, you know, clarifying self-reflection and was just like, nah, concussions are for pussies.
Yeah.
Yep. I mean, look, I'm a tough guy. I've never had a concussion, so.
No,
these guys got thin skulls, you know, they were looking down.
Try not being shit, like, oh man, get a tailored suit, man. They're fucking cool.
I got real mad recently when some people were still in 2023 doing the like, well, you can't skate with your head down discourse when it comes to like head injuries, and I just
Have you tried being a video game character and viewing yourself in third person at all times? Like, you should try that and stop being a weak cunt. Like, yeah.
We're starting... Yeah.
No, we're starting our own version of the footy show, but I'm just going to be like that.
That's right. Okay,
still we very got it. But still himbo. Sorry.
It is time for the beginning of part three.
As we discussed
earlier, Don Cherry has had a tendency to place good old Canadian boys, or, when applicable, good old Ontario boys, first and foremost. But you may be shocked to learn that there might have been conditions on who he really meant by Canadians. This is not specifically that, but here's a moment that got him into some trouble in 2015.
Now, Ron, are you there? Are you going to ask me a question or what? You're in. Where are you? Oh, by the way, you see this? Let's quiet for a minute. You see this? This is St. Valentine's Day because next week some kids are going to make us a suit or something we have to wear. So happy St. Valentine's Day. Okay, go ahead, Ron.
I'm here in St. John's, Newfoundland, as the viewer may have noticed, because of hometown hockey tomorrow, Don. And guess what I had for lunch today?
I know. I heard of eating a seal, a little baby seal. What do you eat seal? I mean, come on. What are you, savage, a barbarian? You. Anyhow, I talk
Mallard's
about the
Cottage. I had a seal burger, and the only challenge for Todd Perrin, the chef, was it was hard to know when to flip her. Anyway, tell me about the Leafs. What's the problem?
Imagine meeting a seal. What kind of barbarian?
Now, are you familiar with the history of seal hunting among Inuit people, particularly in Canada?
I am.
Okay.
Not especially.
That now it's like a... I can't remember if it's been effectively, like it's been made a protected practice for Inuit people, or if I definitely know there's a big push for it solely, that seal hunting should solely be allowed.
That's a good question. I don't know exactly.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if it's protected. It's not explicitly banned. There's just a lot of people who have, like... There's people who have advocated against the seal hunt saying similar things. And like,
there's usually a lot of practices around sustainability and like keeping breeding populations up and things like that. Much more than in like more extractive industrial hunting practices. Mm.
Yeah. And I believe there has been like settler sealing as well. And that has probably been a lot more like, we're not hunting what we need for ourselves. We're hunting a whole bunch to doing it in bulk and to sell it. That stuff does exist. And like, in fairness, I don't think Don Cherry's thought for a moment about any of this. I don't think he really necessarily made the connection. He just hears about, and like, you could even make a critique that it's like, well, if you're getting a seal burger in a restaurant, like you are not hunting it for sustenance. There's no way we can get into the full nuances of seal hunting here, but one thing I absolutely have to correct myself on is it's misleading to suggest that Inuit people don't participate in commercial sealing. If you are familiar with capitalism, you may be aware that people generally don't have much choice but to participate in it, and this trade is an economically viable way of making a living, especially for those living in northern communities. This means that things like the EU's ban on seal products, not to mention the reduced ice coverage due to climate change, have very real effects on people's livelihoods, whether they are Inuit or not.
Hmm.
But I mean, I don't know. I'm not qualified to say what animals are valid to sell in restaurants and which ones aren't. But I mean, again, Don Cherry is off the cuff. He's just going like, I eat cow. You're eating seal at a restaurant. That's fucked up. I feel like that's as far as he thought it through.
Hmm.
Yeah, and once again, I'm really glad you provided context to this because the clip started and he's just talking about eating seals and I'm just like, is he okay? Is he having a stroke of some kind?
Mm-hmm. So this was actually another rare occasion where he apologized and walked back his comments. He said he had no problems with anyone hunting seal, but he had an issue with people ordering a seal burger in a restaurant. And I think kind of per what we just talked about, like there is a certain amount of coherence there, but I also wouldn't want to give him the credit of having really like critically thought about it that much, at least until he got in trouble. He's not saying like, oh, you're participating in industrial farming of animals unsustainably. He said like, you're a barbarian and a savage. Like that's also important to remember.
Why? How dare you eat the cute animal? We only eat the animals that are ugly or boring. Mm.
But luckily, this is not the only possible entryway we have to his opinions on Indigenous people. So I have to give another little bit of context here. Chris Simon was a player with a history of questionable on-ice behavior who happened to be of Ojibwa heritage. The same with Chris Simon's coach at the time, Ted Nolan. And again, the calling back to our Dan George stuff, you notice the very colonial names that people still have. His coach at the time, Ted Nolan, who is something of a mentor figure for him. After the second of a pair of pretty violent on-ice incidents that led to Simon effectively receiving the two longest suspensions ever handed out by the league, and it's also worth noting, like, he deserved these suspensions. These were, like, brutal behavior. While these two suspensions were, as I stated, appropriate given Simon's actions, the viewing audience may have noted that the first incident, a vicious slash to another player's face, came just seconds after that player concussed Simon with a hit. Violent behavior is not unexpected in the time immediately following a traumatic brain injury. You can look up footage of Dennis Weidman, for example, cross-checking an official after having his head slammed into the glass, if you want. But one of the reasons I think these old pieces are important is that they aren't simply frozen in time. Since we initially made these recordings, some of these stories have continued to unfold, and while I was hoping to leave head injuries behind in part two, I definitely need to expand a little further on this one. Although Chris Simon's behavior was turbulent on and off the ice since he was a teenager, he was very adamant that repeated concussions had taken a significant toll on him. In his 2017 bankruptcy filing, in which he claimed to be unable to work, Simon had a doctor testify that he showed symptoms of chronic traumatic encephalopathy, which cannot be formally diagnosed without an autopsy. We will likely find out for certain, as on March 18th, 2024, during the editing of this episode, Chris Simon took his own life at the age of 52. Outlets like CTV News, writing their eulogies, still described him exactly the way Don Cherry would. Once one of hockey's most feared tough guys, the 6'3", 232-pound forward from Wawa, Ontario, and so on. His family publicly blamed CTE for his suicide, and of course, the absolute fucking ghouls who run the NHL doubled down again on their denial of the connection between the condition and repeated head trauma.
One of them involved, like, directly stomping on a guy's leg with his skate.
Oh, shit.
Pretty bad.
Ooh, brutal. Fuck.
So, after this, some very particular discourse erupted. The league executive responsible for player safety made a public statement suggesting that Simon's issues were drug and alcohol related, which a spokesman for his team strongly denied. The National Chief of the Assembly of First Nations for Canada released an official statement requesting an apology from the executive, mentioning it smacks of stereotyping. Simon said nothing publicly, but his coach Nolan agreed, adding, "It really bothered me, the implication, even if it was just a careless omission." I remember reading an article recently about Ted Nolan and him talking about, like, how he was not able to succeed as a coach in the NHL, and he feels like he should have had more offers, but he feels like he was profiled, like he was not treated the way a white person would be treated.
Mm.
So, on his next broadcast, Cherry was actually very even-handed regarding the incident itself, specifically the one of the Simon stomping on some of the skate blade, claiming, "He broke the code. You never do anything like that. Ever, ever do anything like that. But you can understand it somehow." Which is a weird addendum.
Mm. Hey, we all just want to, like, stomp a guy with ice skates, don't we, fellas? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then Ron McLean broached the subject of discrimination and stereotyping.
So what are you saying, that natives have an inferiority complex is when something happens
some,
to them?
I said you'd have to ask Chris, but why wouldn't they? Why wouldn't some kids feel like they haven't been given a fair shake in life? Ask Davis in
fair shake in life. Go out and get your own fair shake in life and work for it. Don't give me that stuff. It's like Ted Nolan. When Ted Nolan didn't get the job, it was racism. Wasn't racism. Him and Muckler got at it, and then that's why he didn't get hired.
Okay. We keep saying, like, you're racist uncle at Christmas, and this is a clip that was recorded at Christmas. So there is a wreath behind him. He is wearing a Santa tie.
Mm-hmm.
He's wearing, like, a red velvety kind of number. Mm. Like, oh, fuck.
Now, this is the only clip we really have him on going off on this group of people, but
arguably a lot of that is because there's been a comparatively limited amount of Indigenous people who have played in the league. And I mentioned that, you know, hockey is a rich kid sport, mm-hmm. and you can make the connections there of like socioeconomic status. The rich kids are disproportionately more white.
Mm.
But, you know, Don still has stuff to talk about, and he has dug deep in the well of old school Canadian racism, and it had some choice words regarding the province of Quebec. What do you know about Quebec?
I know a little bit about Quebec. They speak French there, and they are extremely proud of speaking French and the French heritage. I believe to the point where all chain names have to purely be in French, to the point where KFC is not KFC because it mm-hmm. has to be translated into French, and it's something like...
It's PFK, yeah.
PFK.
I just knew they had PFK. Yeah. I was very surprised to find out in France it's KFC. And I was like, oh, yeah, of course they translated. Poulet frit de Kentucky. Like, of course. Like, yeah, it was very funny to see the rest mm-hmm. of the world. This just blew up on Twitter or on whatever other websites. And I was a little surprised. I was like, oh, I just thought translating was the thing. But yeah. Mm. Yeah. So yeah, Quebec is the French province, and there is language law stuff. And I'm going to say this for the millionth time. We could do an episode on that. It's fascinating.
Yeah.
Honorary Australian Gothic.
Yeah. Kelly. Good. There's a whole episode in that.
You're ticking all the fucking boxes.
This is what happened because I had this basic idea when I watched your Hey Hey Saturday episode of like, we should talk about Don Cherry. And the more I dug into this, it's just a fractal of a connection to another subject that merits so much coverage.
Yeah.
Mm.
So for this specific instance we're going to talk about, I have to offer a little more kind of hockey-ish context. So the following quote, it comes from 1991 when a major controversy erupted around a player I mentioned earlier, one of the concussed players, Eric Lindros, a good old Ontario boy who was slated to go first overall in that summer's NHL entry draft. Now, I know that not every sport has this. Like I know, most Premier League soccer, it's like you have clubs and they sign whatever players they want. I don't think they draft. This is definitely common in North American sports where when you finish in last place, you get first pick of the available players coming into the league. Like, does that strike you as familiar at all? I don't know what happens in any Australian sports.
I don't know enough about that. Sorry.
I don't believe that happens in Australia, but I might be wrong.
Okay.
I've heard about it happening in a few American sports.
Yeah, though. It happens in all the major North American sports. Right. Basically, it's like you have your next crop of people, 18 or about to turn 18, and the scouts have figured out who's highest ranked. And so everyone, especially as time goes on and we've gotten better at like scouting people, you know who's going first. And so there's big hype about who's going first. And they will generally go, we'll simplify now, they will go to the worst team.
Mm.
Mm.
So Lindros was widely hyped to the point of being considered by some observers to be the next Wayne Gretzky. And the Quebec Nordiques, based in Quebec City, who held the first overall pick, were publicly talking about how excited they were to start rebuilding their franchise around him. The snag, however, was that Lindros was publicly stating he would never play for the team. Some have speculated that he might have been motivated by some level of xenophobia on his own. And I think I also should add a mention here, like in North American sports, I think it was basically unprecedented at the time. I think this is one of the only times it's ever happened in North American sports of anyone refusing to play for a team that drafted them.
Right.
It's just sort of part of the culture is like, if somebody drafts you, you go play for them. Like that's just what's going to happen. And their rights to you are protected for several years. So this was a big, big deal of him saying, don't draft me. I will not play for you.
Hmm.
So as I was saying, people are thinking, is he being xenophobic? Quebec City was a small, highly Francophone market,
Like of the two major cities in Montreal, or sorry, in Quebec, like Montreal, highly cosmopolitan city, like full of English speakers. I think it's actually the second biggest population of Francophones in the world after Paris, is a fun fact. Huh. But it, you can get by with a lot of English there. Quebec City is smaller and much more French. He was an English-speaking player who presumably wanted to maximize his endorsement opportunities. But a really important thing I think is important to understand here is that the Nordiques were an absolute dog shit team that had just finished dead last in the league for the third consecutive year. And this is another fun story, but the owner at the time later turned out to be a sex pest.
Uh-huh. Oh.
And one of the, I didn't copy the stuff down, but I will go for memory here. The, one of the things that was alleged to have happened was, so Eric Lindros was an English speaker. I believe his mother spoke French. And so there was like a meeting, because like before these drafts, the teams will meet with these players, interview them, figure out like, you look for red flags, you figure out whether a player is good for your team. Like if they're the very best player, you're probably going to take them. But if you're in the middle, like if you think a kid has behavioral issues, you might not take them, stuff like that. So there was some sort of interview. And what I believe happened was the owner made some sort of comment in French to another person in the room about like basically he was making sexual comments about Lindros's mother. Because it was like, these are English speakers. They don't know what I'm saying. But because she spoke French, she was like, I know what he said. Mm. My son is not going to play for this team. Right. And then later on, the owner turned out to be like an absolute sex pest. Probably something that merits its own investigation.
In trying to fact check this, I found enough that it will probably just become its own episode at some point. For now, I'll just quickly confirm that Marcel Aubut did step down from his role as the president of the Canadian Olympic Committee in 2015 amid a rash of very credible allegations of sexual impropriety. The rumors that he made a salacious comment in the presence of Bonnie Lindros in 1991 are largely based on some pretty vague public comments by former Canadien star Guy Lafleur. Pictured here, as we saw in part 2, being interviewed nearly nude in the locker room at the 1975 NHL All-Star Game by pioneering female reporter Marcel Saint-Cyr.
But yeah, so like when I looked into this, so much discourse about like, was it his decision? Was his family pressuring him? Was his agent pressuring him? So I've expressed this in a fairly, I think, somewhat even-handed, nuanced way. Let's get ready for Don's take.
Come on, Don.
And the things you've said about him down here, he's a racist, the muscle-bound Ontario.
About Lindros.
Like, yeah, about Lindros. Of course I'm talking about Lindros like that. Tearing the fabric of our nations apart. Now look, you don't want to speak English down here. You don't want universities down here English. You don't want signs up. How in the world do you not think an 18-year-old kid from Ontario, and why he doesn't want to come here?
He's afraid.
Oh, he said he'd come and play in front. But Ron, did you fall off a turbo truck? The kid knows the last team in the world they'd trade him to is Montreal in the division and the rival like that. Yeah, I thought you were smarter than that. The kid's smarter than you. Trade the kid. Get on with it. Make the playoffs. You're dumb. Holding the kid in junior hockey. Stupid, stupid play. Get him. Get Robitaille. Well, Robitaille said he wouldn't come here either. So the French don't want to come and the English don't want to come. The only thing left is the Swedes.
Yeah.
Wearing a shockingly understated, just brown striped suit.
But again, it's 1991. You notice like it's really in the 2000s the suit thing kicks off.
Okay, yeah. So can you I had trouble passing that a little bit, but can you tell me what Don's beef was?
So he's saying that people publicly, there's lots of, you know, discourse, capital D discourse going on about why this guy is saying in advance, don't draft me. And then they did draft him. And then he says, I will not play. And what actually happened was he sat out on purpose for a year. He did not play until they finally made a massive, one of the biggest trades in like sports history. It's a wild thing because there's people like, you know, you trade players for picks and picks for players and all this. And people can like trace the echoes of that trade to like current players playing in the league. It's really wild.
So it was hugely impactful. But at the time, so I believe at the time of this clip, they had drafted him and he was still refusing to play. And so he was accused of being, he's using the word racist, probably a better word is xenophobic. And he's saying, like, what do you expect? This is a province where everyone hates English. They won't speak English. They don't want our signs. Why would you want this English speak? Why would this English speaking kid want to play here? And then McLean suggests, like, well, he'd probably play in the more, like, he doesn't hate French people. He said he would play in Montreal, a much more successful team, and, you know, a more English-friendly city. And then Don Cherry is saying, well, like, that's stupid. They would never trade him to a divisional rival. You never trade potentially this generational talent to a divisional rival. And then he says, I thought he said, did you fall off the back of a turban truck? But he said turnip truck. Anyway, not a phrase I've ever heard.
I also heard turban truck.
Yeah. Turbot truck. So I thought, like, oh, that must be like a brand of truck in Canada or something like that. I don't know.
I cut away, but at the end, McLean later says something about a turnip truck. Like, that's how I knew he said turnip, because I couldn't parse it when I heard it.
All right.
Pretty good. In 1993, he reverted to the Anglophones of noted French named town, Sault-Saint-Marie, which, again, a very Anglophone town. They don't know how to speak French. They call their own town Sault-Saint-Marie, and they're dumb and wrong. Learn to speak French. You live in a French town. I've gotten off on a tangent. I'm doing my own Don Cherry here. He referred to the Anglophones of this French named town as ones who, quote, speak the good language. Years later, Cherry had more concerns about French Canadian nationalism.
They don't want the Canadian flag, but they want our money. They don't mind our money. We bail them out, and that there's lots of money. They got the Canadian flag on the dollar. You know, I've never seen such a bunch of whiners in my life.
Okay.
When Olympic gold medalist Jean-Luc Brossard was chosen as Canada's flag bearer at the 1998 Winter Olympics, Jerry complained that they had selected, quote, a French guy, some skier that nobody knows about. And it is a bit hard to determine whether he's more prejudiced against French guys or prejudiced against skiers, if I'm being honest, but... This also reminds me, if we go way back to the very early quotes about, like, don't you worry about proper English, there was a quip that I saw parodied a few times. I think it kind of tended to get reprinted in whenever somebody had to write an article about him a while back that was like, Canada has two official languages, English and French, and Don Cherry speaks neither of them.
That's right.
Yep. So, going back to that 2003 interview on American radio, to defend his comments on the invasion of Iraq, he made a point of highlighting that the fans booing the U.S. anthem were in Montreal. And here's a direct quote from him again. The true Canadians do not feel the way they do in Quebec there. Believe me, the majority of the people in Canada love the United States. We know you'd be there to help us and don't think too bad of us. It's just a damn shame they had to boo the Star Spangled Banner in Quebec. You have to realize it's Quebec and it's French Canadians.
Right.
He could tell by the booing that it was French.
I never noticed.
Le boo.
Oh, hon, 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 hon.
Bon, bon, bon.
Yeah. It's fine. It's fine. My dad's French. I'm allowed to do this.
French Canadian valor.
Yeah. It's also funny. I'd never noticed this till now, but that, like, believe me, like, that's also kind of a Trumpism.
Like, I heard a guy. Yeah.
And then, of course, there is the January 2004 incident. Remember when I said we'd come back to the comments that got him put on a broadcast delay?
Yes.
Well, a hot topic at the time was the subject of visors on helmets, which were not mandatory back then, but the league was considering making them so, which they later did. And you can also remember him making a quip about it with the guys kissing. He's like, oh, that's why you don't wear the visor. It gets in the way. He was kind of referring to that discourse.
Mm.
Don complained that, quote, most of the guys that wear them are Europeans or French guys, end quote. He implied they were a mark of weakness and suggested that their wearers committed more high sticking penalties, which is like a stick to a high area, mostly the face. Mm. This is absolutely not the case, but he said it anyway. The comments provoked a federal investigation by Canada's official languages commissioner and sparked protests from French Canadians.
Oh, wow.
Huh. Not as bad as not as dark as where I thought it was going, to be honest. I thought he was going to get, like, much darker and much more, like, xenophobic.
It's kind of funny because, like, he is genuinely xenophobic, but it's against, like, certain populations you don't necessarily feel as bad for.
Like there is a genuine history of the French being treated poorly, relatively speaking, by the English in Canada. But these are also all settlers. These are also all like all. It's like you were just the colonizers that lost. It's messy, is what I'll say. Mm. It's messy.
No, that's a great point. So this comment about like implying that more French Canadian players, you know, do these, you know, play in a way to injure their opponents. So that is what got him the 7-second delay.
Yeah, or at least that. Yeah, this whole, I think it was one long tirade. There's not a good clip of this. There's one that's been like really aggressively edited around. And I was like, fuck it. We have enough videos. But he basically says all of this probably in one run-on sentence where he says like, the guys wearing them are Europeans or French, that they're weak, that they do more high sticks, which is, it's sort of that argument of like, you drive more poorly if you wear a seatbelt or something like that. It's like, you're less careful with your stick if you have eye protection, and it's just fucking stupid.
Okay, yeah. All right. So that's fair enough. But yeah, like, I guess in Australia, I was almost expecting him, this is the level of darkness that I'm used to in Australia. Is like, I was almost expecting him to make some kind of hijab reference or something like that, or some sort of like face covering or something like that, just because I'm used to that level of fuck shit in my own country.
Yeah. We don't have a group of white people to be racist towards in our country.
Unless you consider Greek people white, like,
We do now. Interestingly,
right.
But historically, yeah, like decades ago, no, but yeah, like Australia's like tiered racism is like that. You know the skin color chart from Family Guy.
Yeah,
that's so. Yeah, it's just that the line of acceptable in the main discourse has shifted in decades. But like, I guess for 2004, my brain immediately went to Islamophobia because that's what was going on over here.
As much as like, I think probably both of you brought up this earlier, like, aren't you supposed to be talking about hockey? Like, he usually is still talking about things adjacent to hockey. Mm. He's rarely talking about something that's completely unrelated. And so again, like, he doesn't have a lot to say about Indigenous people or Muslims because they less often play in the NHL.
Mm.
Like, there's been, like, I think to my knowledge for sure, two Muslim players who played in the NHL. And one was Nail Yakupov. Like, he's from Russia. He's like a Tatar. And his career did not last long. And then you have Nazem Kadri, who is like a Canadian born, you know. He's actually the one guy that he gives a kiss to in the clip. And Nazem Kadri was also outspoken in defense of Don Cherry, saying he was misunderstood. So, like, again, all these things are very messy. But I think the reason you don't see a lot of this, like, this kind of Islamophobic stuff from him is that it just doesn't come up in the hockey world very often. Mm. It's mostly a lack of opportunity, if anything.
Mm.
And, okay, gotcha.
Right? Like, that's kind of my take on it, is I think he's commenting on what's in front of him. And so the most immediate xenophobia is all these damn Europeans and French guys in his league of good old Canadian boys and Americans who, like, his perception on Americans completely varies depending on context, right? Like, you saw the Iraq War stuff. He's very pro-Americans, but we'll get to some other stuff. Europeans, as suggested, were not spared from his barbs. Back in 1989, he was aghast that the Winnipeg Jets had hired a Finn, Alpo Suhonen, to coach their AHL team, the minor league, one of the first ever Europeans to coach in North America at that level. Why did they bring a Finn over to coach Moncton? He was quoted as saying, wasn't a Canadian good enough? I don't wish him well in Moncton. What's his name? Alpo?
Alpo, it sounds like a dog food.
Now, just a minute.
Alpo is, in fact, a brand of dog food.
Okay.
Later, he referred to the ongoing Balkan Wars as Lower Slabovia attacking Slimea.
Just esoteric
bigotry. Very esoteric bigotry.
That's,
and like,
wow.
You get into, it's just a wonderful investigation of intersectionality to really consider a lot of these things. Like, when I think of the Balkan Wars, you're like, yeah, Eastern Europe, a lot of people suffer from ethnic violence. Like, it's not quite as economically advantaged as Western Europe, like that kind of like, and you're talking about like there's genocide going on in like in Serbia at the time, and like that sucks. But like when you're like mad about Finns coaching your Canadian boys, like it's just so it's so silly because I don't feel bad for like very affluent Finnish people.
Yeah. You know?
But it's like, but he has the same level of invective. He just doesn't want these damn Euros. Like, I don't know, man. It's messy.
It's really, yeah, that's like such a specific xenophobia.
Yeah.
It's like an Avenue Q where, you know, the song, everyone's a little bit racist and someone's just like, oh, I hate the Polish. Like, fuck the Polacks or something like that. And it's just, and it's thrown away as just like, that's, it's bizarre for someone to be, to specifically hate the Polish or like, you know, a group you probably don't think about that much in a Western country. It's very strange.
Well, and even like Western country, like it depends where you are, because like here specifically in Western Canada, and somebody turned me on to something recently about like the way they did immigration specifically to the Western Canada. There was all this weird esoteric racism to it as well. And I don't know, again, it's another conversation for another day, but like, hugely Alberta here where I live was settled by a lot of Ukrainian and Polish immigrants. And so like, you don't really get to see the kind of anti-Polish racism you might see in certain parts of like the Anglosphere, because like everyone here has Ukrainian and Polish ancestry. Everyone here has a Polish last name that they pronounce wrong because they don't understand that W's are V's, and it drives me crazy. Okay. In 2014, Cherry went off on his opinions toward the perennial shortcomings of a profoundly cursed franchise, the Toronto Maple Leafs. So, even more so than before, I do have to get a little bit into how hockey works here. Because we've talked a lot about everything else, but there's this sort of thing that gets brought up. And I feel like even I, as like a kind of like soft Don Cherry apologist 15 years ago, would have said something like this. It's like, yeah, he's a loudmouth, he's a clown, but like he understands hockey. Like, you know, that's, he knows what he's talking about. So there's a bit here we're gonna get into where he's so fucking factually wrong about the actual sport itself. So I'm gonna do my best to try to like explain it as accessibly as possible. You have something called the Canadian Hockey League, which is a junior league, which means you basically play it from the ages of like 15 to 19. So you tend to play in this when you are like the best of the best of athletes, you tend to play in this league as your way of like showing your mettle to be drafted. Right. And so it's like, it's fundamentally like a developmental league in its nature, and it's broken into three major leagues. You have the Western Hockey League, it covers Western Canada. You have the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League, which covers like Quebec and east of that. And you have the Ontario Hockey League, which covers Ontario, because it's just by far most populous province. Here is Don Cherry. He's going to talk about, he's comparing to the then very sad sack Toronto Maple Leafs to the then defending league champion, Los Angeles Kings.
I predicted the Maple Leafs would not draft a Canadian, especially guys from the OHL. Let me just tell you that the LA Kings, the Stanley Cup champions, drafted seven guys, a bastard, a Swede, but they drafted seven guys from the OHL. You know how many Canadians the Maple Leafs drafted? Zero. So what do we say? Who did they pick? They picked the little guy. We won't say who it is. They sent him back to Sweden to save his life. They pass on a guy, Nick Ritchie, who is 6'3", 230 pounds, 100 minutes of penalties. Oh, you're going to say he's a dummy, eh? Hey, only three guys in the whole draft scored more goals than this guy. Let's go over the whole thing again. We have the Stanley Cup champions who have won two out of three Stanley Cups, right? They're full of Canadians, full of guys from the OHL, the GTHL too, and they win two out of three. On the other hand, we have the Leafs, who've made the playoffs once in 14 years, and they draft U.S. college guys, and they draft a Swinn and a Fedes. You're telling me, everybody asks me, why the Leafs are they where they are right now? The only impact they've guys they've ever drafted is Wendell Clark in the last 18 years. And I'm a guy, and I'm saying it, if I'm not anymore, I don't care, that's the way it is, and that's the way it is for me.
That's good. Why don't you show your Erie Otters?
I got time?
Yes.
I'm a guy, and I know how it is...
And I say things.
Yeah.
He has a big face. He says things.
So we're looking at a potential like shirt opportunity for Barb here. I will wear one of these shirts.
Now, this is a clip I had to go and find because I was like, I said that there was stuff that I only learned about from researching it. This is one I had to track down this clip because I remembered him saying a Swinn and a feed.
I was going to point that out. It's like, so
okay, you did catch that.
Look, I sometimes say things incorrectly when I'm recording. I can't edit around it.
Absolutely.
But I'm also just some idiot doing this on my own time. I'm not like a mate, one of an institutional broadcaster for a whole fucking country.
This you are not
your
being
7 minutes on national TV. Yes. Like,
it also occurred to me while he was talking about this, as you told us earlier about how when he was a coach, a lot of people have come out and said he was actually a pretty shit coach. He was just a very aggressive one. And he is famously, he loves the biff. He loves it when people fight. He thinks it's a regular part of the sport. And he loves like brick shit house dudes who can just like bowl people over. Now, I'm not a hockey person. I'm going to do a cherry thing. But I assume that being sort of like smaller and faster might be more advantageous in hockey. Like Kelly is someone who has played. What do you think? Is it more advantageous to be a brick shit house or just like real quick?
It's better to be big and quick, honestly.
Okay. Okay. Probably both, but like, it's, but still it's, like, would you,
it's an excellent question. Because so like every single person in Canada, I have a cousin who was drafted in the NHL and he was considered too small to play and he was 5'11". 5'11", yeah.
Wow. Jesus.
Huh.
I think he also had some like injuries too. But like the idea that somebody who is, and you know, I'm gonna sound American enough because we do our height and feet and inches. Mm-hmm. But like people who are like 5'9" are not considered total write-offs anymore. But like it helps you to be big. It is a contact sport. Yeah, almost back. He's the less cuddly cat. So like my roommate, who is the owner of these cats, is out of town. And you can tell they've been getting lonely with how much I worked in the past week and with her being gone. Because like Toshi's very cuddly. Momo is not. And Momo has been jumping on my lap lately.
Look, okay, listen. This was reckless slander. This was a different time. I was young. I was dumb. I fully regret saying this. Momo is very cuddly. He just doesn't give it up as readily as Toshi. He's very particular about his cuddling is all. I've learned from this. I'm growing. It won't happen again.
Like this cat, if you pet him too much, he will like put his teeth on your hands. Like, nice. But now he just wants affection. Mm. Which
I know the
I'm
time.
Fine with. Mm. But you need to put your face on the camera. They can only see your tail.
Huh?
You're so handsome. He's so handsome.
I thought you meant like get his little like snoot up in the camera, which would also be very sweet.
That'd be great. Anyway, he's chilling on my lap, but the camera's not angled to accommodate this.
But you were saying so that like
don't remember what we were talking about.
Not being a 7-foot hulking giant.
Mm-hmm. It's legal
you must
now.
Be this tall to
short kings are legal. but short for hockey purposes, so 5'9".
Yeah.
Look, it just a quick sidebar. It occurs to me like it might be fun, maybe in his retirement, you know, to get John set up Don Cherry so that you can just go feed him prompts and just get him to rant about shit. Like maybe we just
AI
get him in cameo.
Don,
just like,
Don Cherry.
Like, oh, Don Cherry, what do you think about a fucking Settlers of Catan?
Oh my god, and Don then Cherry just on cameo? I've never thought about this. He might be. We got to look up whether he's on cameo.
You got to look up a wood. It would be beautiful.
We'll circle back to this. The short answer. So the question you're asking is very interesting. It is a thing that is debated by people forever.
Mm.
And we'll kind of touch on this, but like something I didn't make a note of is that what I often saw from like, I got a lot of my like hockey discourse from Reddit for a while. And it's like people who are a little more attuned to the like modernization and to looking at things in new ways. Mm-hmm. And they would point out that, so he talks about the Los Angeles Kings. They won in 2012 and 2014, 2 and 3 years, as he says. And they kind of quickly fell off after that. And people said there's a big shift after that. And the way they played was too big and too slow. So there is a benefit to being fast. One of the caveats there is that, like, it also depends on how you call the rules. If people are allowed to flagrantly violate the rules, if they're allowed to make illegal hits, if they're allowed to constantly hold on to you and not get penalized for it, then your speed doesn't matter. And people have advocated that, like, if you call the penalties more aggressively, you will let these talented, fast, nimble players show their skill, and it's a much more entertaining product to watch. And this is a whole debate, and I'm very in favor of calling more penalties and phasing out like contact is such an inherent like thing. Yeah, it that's we you can't get me started on actual hockey play because like it's such a thing. Yeah. So like it's a great question because people are willing to debate it endlessly. Yeah. So in this specific example, I think you can kind of prove he's fairly comprehensively wrong. And it's also, this is another thing that kind of reminded me, I was trying to like not lean into it too heavily, but you talk about Trump comparisons. There was this like weird thing where Trump was talking about how like tall the generals were.
Yeah.
And like how handsome the generals were, which is like very stupid in, you know, terms of like military command. Like being tall is a benefit if you are going to play a sport generally. So, but I also want to get out of the, go ahead.
Oh, just there was a moment in that clip where I thought like, oh, it's very Trumpy as well. He's like talking about like, yeah, he's very handsome, he's very tall, you know, that sort of weird, like just making insinuations about this person's character based on physical attributes, which is just something.
They're both really, really into a specific kind of masculinity. That's like, it does border on the homoerotic, but like, yeah.
God. We're going to like find a bunch of sketches in his notebook when he dies.
Oh, dear.
I couldn't possibly comment on these things, but this is Jules' region to comment on.
Yeah. I'm just like...
Not to tokenize, but as a member of the queer community, I'm willing to just let you just go off on that one.
Yeah, I'll tell you what's queer. Yeah.
Yeah, I'll tell you what's queer. I know I've been queer the whole years. I grew up in the queer bars in Southern Ontario.
Anyway.
Well, I saw a trough man and he loved to be pissed on. Let me tell you, kids, you young kids out there, the gay sex they're having in Finland, they're not doing it right. They don't know the Canadian way. Okay. Sorry. The right height for a glory hole, it needs to be up this high. You know, tall guy, really. This guy, 6'6", they had to drill a new glory hole because his legs are so tall.
Maybe they should let the two of you be the queer Don Cherries.
Just wearing more and more like upsetting suits.
So, as I said, my analysis is that he's comprehensively wrong here. So, for starters, and I mentioned this earlier, when he gives specific numbers like 14 years with only one playoff in appearance or 18 years since he drafted a certain player, these numbers are wrong. They're just straight up wrong. I think they went 9 years without a playoff appearance, something like that. And as for the second thing he was saying in terms of like, he says 18 years since they drafted this guy. They drafted the guy like 29 years earlier. It's baffling. I was like, I can't even get drilled into this. He's just making up numbers. He just pulls things out of thin air as far as I can tell.
That's right.
So that's awesome. Maybe that's nitpicking, but it seems to be a theme where it's like, it feels like numbers are more of a rhetorical flourish than like actual data. And it's also entirely possible he just doesn't know what year it is after a certain point. But in this clip we just watched, go ahead.
So the longer we go on recording, the more I'm coming around to like, actually, this guy's awesome. He's like made his whole career to just like go on TV and for 7 minutes a week just say fucking nonsense. Like, this is aspirational to me.
Yeah. This is my definitive take. Don Cherry is a land of contrasts.
Yikes.
But more importantly, so here specifically in the clip we just watched, he tried to make two clear arguments. First, he's an expert analyst who makes great predictions. But he's dead wrong about these players. So we have the benefit of hindsight. Nearly a decade later, the little guy who they sent back to Sweden is a player named William Nylander, who has since turned into a top-tier player in the league and has more than double the career points of Cherry's beloved 6'3", 230-pound Nick Ritchie, and is also only 3 inches shorter, from what I can tell.
Those are the critical inches.
Yeah.
I can't resist the urge to pile on this a little more because this might be about as wrong as anyone's ever been. These two players make a great comparison because, for one thing, the Leafs actually got to have it both ways. In the summer of 2021, they signed Nick Ritchie as a free agent, with William Nylander still playing for them. Nylander played on the second line and finished the ensuing season third in team scoring with a very solid 80 points in 81 games. Ritchie was placed on the top forward line alongside the team's top two scorers from the preceding season, who then each posted career-best point totals for themselves. In such vaunted company, Ritchie managed 9 points across 33 games for the Leafs until he was sent down to the minors and traded away. I did a little experiment and just searched these two players' names on YouTube. Now, you're probably not a professional hockey analyst. You might not even care in the slightest about hockey or any sports at all. You might even only be listening to the audio of this, and yet I still guarantee you can tell the starkness of the difference here. Amongst a glut of promotional fluff pieces, the top result for William Nylander is a compilation of highlight reel goals and assists published by the NHL. Here's a sample.
Tyson Berry for Marner. In front, Nylander scores! What a goal! Nylander puts it through his legs and in! This is absolutely unbelievable by Nylander.
Searching for Nick Ritchie yields a bunch of fights, with a few late hits sprinkled in for variety. Here's an example of the latter.
And here's a hit. I mean, it's
that was a late hit. Is that Ritchie?
It's long gone, yeah. I believe it's Ritchie, yep. That puck is long gone.
Yeah,
that's from a dirty behind play.
Yeah, that's a five-minute penalty.
Yep, that is dirty.
That was late from behind.
Even since the initial recording of this episode, the gap has grown wider. At the time I was writing these notes, in March 2024, William Nylander was in 7th place in the entire NHL for scoring. Meanwhile, Nick Ritchie managed 5 points in 10 games in the Finnish Elite League before being hit with an 8-game suspension for throwing a player to the ice, then repeatedly punching him in the head while he was down. His team then terminated his contract.
He was also wrong about the teams. In the intervening time since that clip, Toronto has had more playoff appearances and won more playoff series than the Los Angeles Kings. And even not understanding sports, basically, just from what I was explaining about drafting, it's like he's talking about past success and he's criticizing their drafting, which is inherently banking on the future.
Yeah.
So he's saying this team that has won recently has to win in the future, but like he was wrong because He's apples and oranging with past and future stuff.
So he's a bit like one of those film critics who you don't always agree with, but you can figure out if you like the movie based on what they're saying. So is this why people in Canada like him? It's just like, okay, make the opposite picks of what Don Cherry says, because he's just like, you know, kind of so wrong about stuff that you can discern the truth.
Maybe. I mean, certain things are subjective, certainly in film. There's certain things that are still subjective, like, are you hampered by being small or whatever? But the things I really wanted to actually, I thought were worth getting into the weeds for, were the stuff where, like, he's just objectively wrong.
Hmm.
So, because he said this player is going to be better and this player was measurably worse. And the second argument he makes is that Canadians, and especially, again, he doesn't say just drafting from Canada. He's just drafting from the OHL. He has this, like, again, it's so esoteric, but within the context of Canadians, he likes the Ontario boys better. And he's willing to die in that hill. So he argues Canadians are simply better and Europeans, pound for pound, cannot keep up in the North American game. But again, with the benefit of hindsight, this also does not hold up. So I went and I took the draft he was talking about in question, and I re-ranked those players by the number of points scored since from 2014 to now. So of the top 10, 6 are the hated Europeans. 1 is of the barely tolerated U.S. college guys, and only 3 are Canadian. Only 1 played in Don's precious OHL, and his good old Ontario boy, Nick Ritchie, does not make the top 20.
Just to head off anyone as pedantic as me, I am fully aware that William Nylander, himself the son of a Swedish NHL player, was born in Calgary, Alberta, and spent the bulk of his childhood living and playing hockey in North America. This doesn't matter to Don, of course, so for our purposes here, it doesn't matter to us either.
Okay, but if we rank them on how well they kiss, though, I bet we would find Don's charts, like, you know, it's not actually based on hockey, it's based on kissing now.
This is why they need you in the advanced stats community, because nobody is even tracking kissing ability.
Yeah. That's what the queer Don Cherry would really track.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Another interesting little footnote here is that Don Cherry's relationship to Canadian supremacist drafting was not purely theoretical. From 1998 to 2002, he was one of the founding co-owners of his own OHL team, the Mississauga Ice Dogs, and had his hand in managerial duties during that time. In the CHL, which is the overarching junior league, teams are annually allowed to draft up to 2 import players, meaning not Canadian, not American. In that context. And they're allowed to maintain 2 import players on the roster. And again, the reason for that protectionism is that it's supposed to be developmental. The European's supposed to play in Europe. The local, the North American players play here.
Yeah.
Cherry, bravely, refused to participate in the import draft as an owner, insisting that it should be a league for Canadians, and did his best to trade their import draft picks away. Incidentally, in the first 3 seasons of existence, the Ice Dogs had the worst record in the CHL, winning only 16 of 204 games.
Oh.
Grapes relented and drafted 1 Russian and 1 Ukrainian, quite rare actually, at the next import draft. Having fired 5 coaches in that time, Cherry took to the bench himself for their 4th season, leading the club to a comparatively impressive 11 games in the 68-game season.
Wins. 11 wins in 68 games.
That offseason, his co-owners sold off their shares in the team.
Okay.
And that's it. That's it for stats and sports analysis. We're back to xenophobia.
This club into the ground.
Yep. Oh.
He didn't help it, that's for sure. Not only did our subject take exception to what he considered to be the soft style of European hockey, he regularly went after any players he considered too flamboyant, especially when it came to celebrating goals.
Flamboyant? And
a man with those suits!
Right?
Okay, listeners, you've probably noticed every time a clip started, I go like, ah! And that's because we're confronted by a new fucking suit that actually hurts to look at.
Like, if you were the most buttoned-down, non-theatrical person in the world... I get it. He's so flamboyant. He's allowed to be a flamboyant analyst, but you can't be a flamboyant player.
Well, maybe he's scared they're going to, steal his job. Yeah.
Fucking Lee Bowery would look at these suits and be like, oh, that's a bit much, hey? Right? I'm shocked that he hasn't rocked up wearing a fucking mirror ball suit or some shit. Like, I don't know. Maybe I've laved it in.
Maybe he has.
We'll have to double check. Exhibit A here is another Russian by the name of Alexander Ovechkin.
What I try to do is teach the kids just the Canadian way. What we have to watch is we don't start acting like those goofy soccer guys. Now watch this. Watch the soccer guys first.
You want, sure.
All right, watch the soccer guys first. Yeah, and I'm screwing you up here. But watch the way these guys act. Now watch this. Yeah, maybe it's better showing these goofs like the way they act. Now watch. Look at this. This is what we want our hockey players to act with. All right, now watch Ovechkin. Does this not remind you of it? Look at this. Does he not remind you of a soccer player? And that's what Crosby was talking about. Look at him. We kids act like Joe Thornton, act like Sakic, act like Gaginla, Shanahan, Bobby Orr, Yzerman, Guys like that. Look at this guy. Now, you know what? I'm going to tell you about this guy. He's got a free ride. He runs at guys, does this stuff, makes fool of pig. I am predicting somebody's going to get him, and somebody's going to get him good. There's somebody out there, some big defenseman, is going to be sitting in the weeds. As he cuts across center ice, somebody's going to cut him in half. You don't act like this goof. This is goofy stuff.
Is he doing stochastic terrorism against this one player?
I sure would hate if something bad happened to this guy. Also, shut the fuck up, Don. The bit where, okay, we saw a bunch of scenes of, like, soccer players and then hockey players, like, you know, showboating a little bit, or just, like, you know, pumping their hands, you know, being happy. And come on, like, I don't know that much about sport, but they're, like, they're doing it during a point where, like, not a lot of gameplay is happening, so it's probably fine. I don't know, not very humble. There's a bit where, like, this dude jumps up and bounces off the fucking plexiglass, and that was cool as shit. I love
it. It was great.
That was fucking cool. Dudes rock.
And, like, I enjoy a little bit of goal celebration because like, I think it's nice for the game to take a little break and everyone's excited. Everyone gets to be excited about it. Like, obviously, you know, the sport I mostly watch is soccer. So most of the time there's not that many goals in the match. So there's like, it's a big deal when someone scores. But I don't know. Hockey's similar. Sometimes there's not like, it's not like, you know, the footballs where you might have a score of like 100 in a game, something ridiculous like that. Right. Like there's space, there's time for a little like, make a fuss.
Mm-hmm.
I'm enjoying, like, Don Cherry, like, saying, like, look at these kids, they're doing dances, and they're like, there's, like, some soccer players doing, like, what I think might be the Dougie or something like that. It's just like, oh, look at these kids, they're doing the Dougie, they're doing the dab. Like,
oh, yeah.
I'm surprised there wasn't, like, some soccer players, like, flossing and Don Cherry just being like, oh, damn it, no! How dare they?
Pretty much. I mean, like, again, not to give him too much leeway here, but like, this is a problem with hockey culture in general. Like, in some ways, the way he was going after these players, like, of all the things people will defend him on, a lot of people were not with him. Most people are fine with pretty reasonable goal celebrations, I would say. He was definitely standing on his own dime island for a lot of this, but at the same time, there is this really insane thing in hockey culture, particular to North American sports, because like the complete opposite is basketball. And I fucking hate basketball. I will go on for an hour about how I hate basketball. But the league has been very good at marketing their league and marketing their players because they trump up their players' personalities and they encourage players to have personality. And they want the media and the like, everyone wants people in hockey to have the fucking personality of I already said like wet slab of tofu, but that's what it is. And it's just baffling. Like, you just have to just be Mr. Serious, do not react, do not make quips or push back on reporters in the post game. And it's like, it's so fucking weird. And so he's not alone in that sense, but also just like the way he's just going hard on goal celebrations particularly is like probably one of the things he has the least support of. But I have good news for our friend here, Alexander Ovechkin, who he was targeting. It did take about 9 years, but Ovechkin did grow on Cherry, who would, of course, find a new target to be apoplectic about, is Ovi's teammate, Evgeni Kuznetsov, whose name he absolutely cannot pronounce.
Oh, Cliff,
I'm so
Cliff,
excited
Cliff.
To interview you, and some of the fans were like, Don Cherry hates the Capitals, so let's settle the score.
No, I don't hate the Ovi. I was in Ovi's corner. Remember about 2 or 3 years ago, he was having a tough time, and they were saying he couldn't skate. I see he looks pretty good to me. No, I don't like the Birdman. Everything in Canada, we act like no other sport. And Kuznetsov, is that his name? I call
Kuznetsov?
Well, whoever, whatever. And we try to act in Canada. Most of the players try to act after, you know, you celebrate, Ovi, you celebrate. No, the only guy I don't like is the Birdman first.
Kuznetsov.
Yeah, whatever his name is.
The Birdman is so good.
Yeah.
That's what I'd nickname someone that, not because I couldn't pronounce their name, just because, like, I was like, this guy's the Birdman. And then he did a little flappy celebration. He was a bird.
What I love is that Cherry is old enough and excitable enough that you would suspect he is seeing a bird man. And he's like describing this to his therapist or some shit. I don't like the bird man. Okay, Mr. Cherry, so yeah. You need to
is
regularly
is the
bird take man
in the
medication.
Room with us now?
When do you see this bird man?
Yeah. The bird man.
Evgeni, this is a guy who, not that I can talk, but this is a guy that can barely speak his own language, so like...
Mm-hmm. In the 2018 playoffs, Kuznetsov drew attention for his arm-flapping goal celebration, which you may not be shocked to hear has its origins in the FIFA soccer video game. This so infuriated the Paisley Crusader that he cheered on Kuznetsov leaving Game 2 of the Cup Finals with an injury, and nearly being injured again the next game.
See the Birdman? You're a wise guy. You're going to get it. And he gets it pretty good. Watch McNabb give him here the extra little shot. You want to be a wise guy? You want to remember kids? You want to jump around? This is what happens to you. I used to give the extra little shot there all the time. And tonight, he gives it to him again, but he didn't hurt him.
Wow, that's really malicious.
Mm-hmm.
Also, just going back a little bit, it's funny how I didn't realize these were inspired by FIFA, because when you were showing the celebrations, it made me think of how when you get a goal in FIFA, you can press a button combination and make your player do the robot. So it was, so yeah, it's funny that they fed back into each other. But weird the glee he's taking from watching a dude like just get smacked for no reason.
Oh, you just wait. Despite Cherry's impotent rage, Kuznetsov led all players in playoff scoring that year, and his team took home the franchise's first ever Stanley Cup. Ever the gracious and deferential one, Don was still mad about the celebration 7 months later.
Birdman.
Birdman, remember now how many times I know you people. Players, remember. Now, this happened last week. I couldn't believe it. And the Birdman, look, he gives it that in front of their bench. Watch what Columbus does when they score the Birdman. I know what I'm going on. Now watch this in Columbus. Yeah, you do not make fun. You're Russian in that. You do not make fun of a team when you score. You play the game. That's the Canadian way. And Columbus just showed. You know how players remember? Just like I said. You listen to me. Don't listen to anybody else. All right.
You had to be happy seeing that. It's unbelievable. It
and also... Hold on. And also, he was still mad 2 months after that.
This is Kuznetsov doing your favorite.
What's the jerk now after he scores a goal? This is a very important game right here.
He's that's wearing a Mac OS X fucking background from 2009 as a suit.
It's beautiful.
Yeah. Oh, this is a very important game right here. This is like the two best teams right here. Now, he does a jerk thing like this. Now watch the overtime goal Hegman gets, like he do. We'll show it again because we show this here on Hockey Night in Canada because we think it's late. Now he misses here. He's deep in the end. Watch Hegman get the goal. Remember, kids, Hockey Night in Canada, karma hockey. They always come back. He's not even in the thing. He is a jerk, and he inspires the other team. And remember, kids, never inspire the other team.
Like, he's it wasn't even specific. He was like, the team eventually lost that game. Karma.
And it seems like he's like, don't do any kind of celebrations because it could then be used to insult you later. I don't know. You're going to find ways to tease each other. That's dumb.
Yeah, just win. Just win and you'll be fine, right? Like, but we have to ask. Why did our friend Evgeni endure all this criticism, all this bad karma, all this danger the whole time? Well, he explained in interviews during this period that his 3-year-old daughter, Yesenia, loved it.
Aww.
Some people still not like it, right? But, you know, as long as my daughter, she like it, and every time I get back home, first thing she asks me, like, why you did not do the bird cell? And then I feel so bad because she started crying every time. I will always speak my daughter's side than some other people, right? And that's who I am.
Yeah, choosing your kid over Don Cherry seems reasonable.
Yeah.
Tell me he reacted to this.
I don't know that he did.
Like this, my daughter, she slept on some floors, man. Like,
honestly, that's the end of the clips I have for Don Cherry being mad at Kuznetsov. But it's just so, it's so petty. It's so pointless. Like, of all the things.
I've got a flag that my headphones are giving me the we're running out of battery noise. There's only two things I can plug, like two USB slots on my computer. So I'm now going to have to sacrifice video for this. Sure. So I'm very sorry.
That's fine. We did this to ourselves.
We did. Okay. All right. Bye, everyone.
So that was him explaining it in some, like, you know, decent English. There was a Russian language interview where he explained it. So I got a little help with translating it. So here's him going into a little more detail about the consequences of when he doesn't do the bird celebration. It's hard to explain to a child that when you score, you can't control your emotions. It either happens naturally or it doesn't. My family doesn't attend many home games because they start at 7 p.m. and they have to wake up early for preschool at 7 a.m. But they came to a particular game and I scored in the second period. My wife told me that our daughter was so disappointed when I didn't do the birdie celebration.
Aww.
Well, she said, at least you redeemed yourself by doing it in overtime. We drove home after the second period, and for 2 hours on the road, I heard about how Daddy forgot to do the birdie celebration. I asked my wife to explain to Yesenia that it doesn't always work out. She replied, you explain it yourself. So now I have to think about it.
Aww.
That's, I can fully sympathize with your very little child telling you about the same thing for 2 hours. So,
yeah.
But also, like, I don't give a fuck. I'll do it if it makes my kid happy.
It's so wholesome.
Yeah. It's so Don beautiful.
Is so mad.
Mm.
So on that, go ahead.
It's sort of, it reminds me of this a thing that happened recently in the World Cup soccer. One of our Hayley Rasso, who is one of the Australian players, one of the Matildas, a really good scorer, always wears ribbons in her hair, and it's always like a ribbon the same color as whatever uniform kit they're wearing. And she started wearing it for the televised games so that her grandmother could see her, could tell which one she was. And her grandmother sends her the hair ribbons in the right colors. And like, and people were so angry about it. They were so mad that she was wearing like cute little hair ribbons around her ponytail. And it was like, and she was like, yeah, it's so my grandma can see me on the pitch.
It's such a weird thing to get angry about. Who gives a shit?
That's like the thing. Like, I feel like the clips we saw with the concussion stuff was like the most damning stuff we've seen. But this is just like, it really illustrates. It's like, there's no reason for this. You're just being a dick because you just get a platform to do it.
There's no point.
You really clarify. It's just like, good, you're smashing someone so fucking bad they get a lifelong brain injury. Bad, doing a little dance when you get a goal in a game that seems to be like, you know, decently tense enough that getting a single goal can like really put you ahead.
And it's not even an elaborate celebration. Like, you know, the noted, like, I mean, like some of the soccer celebrations are a bit elaborate, and like American football, especially, they do really elaborate end zone celebrations. Like, they're not doing an elaborate scene that they're setting up. He is flapping his arms after he scores. For the audio listeners, that's what was happening. He was flapping his arms when he scored. Like,
from the way Don was going on about all these different celebrations, I thought they would be much, much bigger. But they're really quite, they're like a few seconds and then it's back to business. It's not even like, it's, and I mean, the hugging is already part of it. Like, he doesn't have a problem with people hugging each other after a celebration, right? It's the little
doesn't have a problem with people kissing each other,
Definitely not. Yeah. So, like, it's not
flamboyance
really
for me, but not for thee.
Yeah.
So, you're going to like this part. to take a very quick break from xenophobia. Concurrently with those later clips, Cherry had a similar beef with an entire team, the Carolina Hurricanes. After many years near the bottom of the standings, the franchise was finally becoming good again, and their core of young players took to orchestrating elaborate on-ice celebrations after games won at home. You can imagine how he took this.
So why are you mad at Carolina?
All right, now, listen. This is the National Hockey League. Brendan Moore is a good coach. He play. These guys, to me, are jerks. You have to do this in the National. They're still not drawn. This is to me, and I'll tell you one thing. They better not do this in the playoff. What I don't understand is Brendan Moore is a straight shooter. He always was. This is a joke. The rest of the guys, young men expressing themselves for joy of winning. You don't do this thing in the net. It's professional hockey. One of these guys are jerks or something. And I'll tell you one thing. They do this in the playoffs, making fun of the other team.
But nobody's out on the ice. The game's over.
This is... Okay, so the game was over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that there was a guy dressed as a mouse? A rat?
Their mascot, awesome. I guess.
Yeah.
Possibly. I
miss God, that. I hope so.
No, just one player is a furry.
Yeah.
Yeah. He also mentions, I don't think I wrote this down, but he also mentions like, oh yeah, Rod Brind'Amour, Canadian guy, of course. He's the coach, you know, I don't understand like why he'd allow this. It was like the coach's idea to be like, why don't we do something fun for the fans? And that's the rationale, like not unlike the daughter thing. It was for the fans.
It's nice to have a little bit of fun. It's nice and it should be legal.
Yeah.
It reminded me a little bit of, you know, for some reason my brain went to Disney on Ice a little bit just because it was a little bit like theatrical and silly. And I don't know, to be honest, like Don Cherry's commentary kind of was noise to me because I was too busy watching them. Like they were doing like baseball. Like if you're just listening to this, they were doing baseball. They did bowling and all the players were pins. And so Don Cherry was just like sort of noise over watching like these guys just be these ice skaters be silly guys. Or like, sorry, watching these hockey players do ice skating effectively.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't know, like that just made it funny of just like hearing this noise of this like grumpy old man over like just dudes having fun.
Well, and also, like you say, like, oh, like ice skaters, hockey players, who cares? Like, they're playing a fucking game. They're already doing something inherently silly. They're just doing something else that's silly.
Why can't they just win and just be somber and go stare at the wall? Just go eat baked beans in their sad kitchen like I did when my wife died.
Right? But you're going to love this. The fans and team together wore that jerks label proudly.
Oh, that's really cute.
Yeah. So for those listening, we have like an image of it's common, very common in the playoffs for teams to throw out like rally towels over all the seats in the building. So everyone can wave a towel. It looks really cool on TV. It's very wasteful, but that's not neither here nor there at this point. But they've left blanks in those areas so that the seats in the building spell out jerks. And they've got a bunch of jerks projected on the ice. And then the towels themselves say bunch of jerks on them. And then they have like fans with giant signs saying bunch of jerks. It's great. Like this is an example I remember pretty well of like everyone thought he was being stupid and everyone loved, at least from people I ever saw, like everyone loved the team just like saying, no, fuck you. It's great.
That's beautiful.
I want to get into like how angry this made Grapes.
He's so mad.
But yeah, how angry was Don after seeing this?
I don't have a reaction to this. Right, so I did find this.
The storm surge ended well before the playoffs began, but Cherry's still going. This time, name-calling the fans.
The owner said, entertain the crowd. And they still draft at 13,000 to 14,000 people. And these people that are here now they're winning. Front-running fans, as far as I'm concerned. That's what they are, front-running fans, as far as I'm concerned.
Cherry's comments have already rippled through social media and will no doubt drive the fans up another octave if he comes to town for the finals.
I said they look like a bunch of jerks, being a fish in the water, a bowling ball with a this is professional hockey, and no sport in the world does it except them. And it come down from the top. I want you to interfere. I want to entertain the fans. The fans there now, they're 17 and 18,000. They're front runners. They're there because they win, not because they act like fish.
But I just wanted to cap that part off with the response, because we do have to get back to xenophobia.
Sorry, I did just remember. No, I did just remember my other point. I'm sorry. I know we're running long, but it occurs to me the way he says "bunch of jerks," he kind of slurs it a little bit in sort of an old man way. Like it occurred to me watching all these videos, like, "bunch of jerks," and
it's impotent rage. He's like, "There's a bunch of jerks."
So, and yeah, it occurred to me that people watching hockey at this point was just like, "Oh, this old dickhead," and the way he keeps calling people jerks is, It's great to see them rinsing him like this.
The public opinion shift is relevant. So let's get into the home stretch here. As you may have gathered, while Don never met a European he couldn't mock, he was all too happy to go especially hard on Russians. In 1991, for instance, he took to the air to suggest that the league's now sizable number of Russian players were overpaid and underperforming. He had this to say to them.
I can say it again, if these guys don't like it here, they come over here, give them a break, they're earning for their apartment. If they don't like it here, the foreigners don't like it here, go back where they came from.
We've heard that before.
And another thing, one more thing, and you're hearing it again, one more thing. In the you bring the Russians and not a junk over here, wait a minute, for scoring. You don't bring them over here to hit, you don't bring them over here to back check, fight. God, they would never fight, for sure, eh? Now, wait a minute, yeah, for sure. You bring them over here to get points. You know how many foreigners there are in the top 22 scoring in the league? One. So they don't hit, fight, they don't score goals. All they do is take our money back.
Is he wrong on those stats as well?
Honestly, I didn't check him, but at this point, I'm just like, he probably is.
Yeah.
And it's just like, it's so weird to hear the exact rhetoric that is used so violently against like people of color of like, they just take our money. They do go back where they came from and use it against like, again, it's not just all Russians. It's specifically the people that come over and make a bunch of money. It's like, I just don't feel that bad for the millionaire Russians, but like,
yeah,
he's just so mad.
And again, there's that focus on like, no, the hockey I like is brutal and people get like grievously injured.
Mm-hmm.
It's weird. I know that's an older clip and maybe he's like softened a little bit because it sounds like he's still broadcasting, which is amazing. It's weird. It's weird that he just wants players to biff on each other. That's very strange. Mm.
And like, I will not dwell on this because we do want to move on, but like there is a very bit of a reality where like specifically like the Soviet Red Army team, like they developed a more like movement based style of hockey that really affected the way we play today.
Huh.
And is a factor in why it's less about gooning people. He's not attaching it to nothing, but anyway. There's more xenophobia to cover, so like we'll get a clear picture. So in 2002,
gooning has a particular meaning in this, sorry. Right?
I mean being a goon, like being a person who just brutalizes people.
Because I didn't know gooning meant jacking off. That's what gooning is, right?
I think it's edging yourself for a really long time.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not necessarily a verb, but goon is definitely like a noun to refer to an enforcer type. Hence the fairly well-known like hockey-themed movie Goon. Which, honestly, haven't seen it, so I couldn't tell anything about it. But in 2002, another Olympic year, after two Russian Olympic athletes tested positive for darbepoetin, which the IOC considered a performance-enhancing drug, he proclaimed, "I've been trying to tell you people for so long about the Russians, what kind of people they are, and you just love them in Canada with your multiculturalism. They're quitters, and evidently they take a lot of drugs, too."
Good Lord.
Completely unsurprisingly, this sentiment tracks all the way back to the days of the Soviet Union, as evidenced by this clip from 1989, which is around the first time you had, like, Soviet defectors coming to play North America. So here we go.
Soviets such as Vyacheslav Petisov are being called a lot more than that in their first NHL season.
Are you kidding me? These guys are too fat. They're way too fat.
Huh.
Huh. Oh, boy.
This one conversation to be had about fat shaming, which I'm sure we're all familiar with. There's also, like, not to validate his position, I don't think they were particularly, like, fatter than the North Americans. I, like, it just feels very left field.
Yeah, it seems... Yeah, I was like, comparatively, I couldn't really tell.
I appreciate the word. Yeah, again, not to like play into his stupid game, but it's just like, yeah, this very athletic looking dude who's like wearing padding and a thick jersey. So like, I can't really tell much about his physique, but I don't know. It just seems like he's being an asshole there.
And again, you're critiquing 20-somethings often for yourself as like a 50-year-old. But like, we don't need to validate his position, but if you want to call these athletes fat, like they're not fatter than you. Like, sorry, man. Like,
yeah.
Let's get this cunt out on the ice and just see like who can skate for the longest. Yeah.
I feel like if he scored a goal, he would do the most flamboyant celebration.
He would do a backflip and then his uniform would explode off to reveal like an even more ostentatious uniform.
Yes.
Didn't have a chance. Again, one NHL game. One.
Shit, that's right. Yes.
Yeah.
Oh.
Oh, goodness.
That was that stat right from the beginning and now. Yep, okay.
But perhaps nothing got grapes redder and madder at Russia and Europe than the 1996 World Cup of Hockey. And here's another rabbit hole I got into, but I have to quickly summarize it. A proper international tournament between the world's best players has historically been difficult to put together. We don't have the same World Cup traditionally that like soccer, rugby, lots of sports have. From 1976 to 1991, though, there were five incarnations of a tournament called the Canada Cup, spearheaded by a good old Ontario boy, a lawyer named Alan Eagleson, who I knew nothing about before starting. Eagleson is a massive figure in the history of the game. He was the first significant player agent and the first head of the Modern Players Union. Of course, we love a union boy.
Yes, we do.
A position he held for 25 years. Some people give him credit for a substantial increase in salaries and benefits during that period. Quite possibly true. But perhaps more importantly, in the early 90s, a handful of journalists started digging into his affairs. And as it turns out, he had spent his entire career embezzling money from the Canada Cup proceeds, players' retirement pensions, and even their disability payouts when they suffered career-ending injuries.
Ah.
Yeah.
Mm.
I really tried to get into a breakdown of numbers. It's hard to come across, but it was stated in court he stole upwards of $1 million Canadian dollars from player pensions alone.
Huh. Jesus.
Yep.
Ooh.
And there was specific examples of like a person would get a career-ending injury and they would get a payout of like, okay, this is what you get paid out to, you know, support you the rest of your life. And he was just like taking 10% off the top of those.
Yeah.
Pretty bad.
No. Mm.
Alan Eagleson was charged by both the FBI, you know, American FBI and Canadian RCMP with dozens of counts of fraud, racketeering, and embezzlement. He was eventually fined $1 million Canadian, sentenced to 18 months in prison, of which he served six, disbarred from practicing law in Ontario, stripped of the Order of Canada, and perhaps worst of all, forced out of the Hockey Hall of Fame. By the time 1996 rolled around, the name of his baby was officially changed from the Canada Cup to the World Cup of Hockey, and it proceeded without his involvement. Out of everything I just talked about, guess what Don is upset over?
Oh, I've just been like waiting to like looking for Don in the wings.
It's yeah. Like, what
Oh God, I'm rolling my Don dice. Like,
name of the cup name change.
Let's watch.
So I'm tired. That's it. I don't want to say anymore. I don't like the name. I'm going to have my say tonight and then I'm going to, that's it.
And you're leaving?
No. Yeah, I might leave. Don't like them, like the Russians. Can't scare them. Anyhow,
they are much more like us in the way they play the game now than they used to be.
Yeah. Quiet, eh? Okay. I don't understand a lot of things in this whole thing. First of all, I don't like the name World Cup because it's World Cup soccer and all stuff like that. Second of all, it should be Canada Cup. It's our name. I'm not getting to a tirade. I don't like the format. What's the Czechs doing in here? What's the Slovaks doing in
Czechs
here?
Czechs are the world champions.
I don't care. They might not ever win a game unless they play the Soviaks or something, whatever it is. What's the Germans doing in here?
He's already mentioned the Czechs. He's already mentioned the Slovaks. Mm. And the fact that he understands in 1996 that Czechoslovakia has been split into two countries, he's already mentioned the Russians. So I don't know who he thinks the Soviaks are. But he said it.
Yep.
Oh, boy. Like, people have lost their pensions. This guy defrauded a bunch of people. He's like, I don't like the name. I don't like learning new things. And look, I respect him as our beautiful boy who hates learning new stuff. I get it.
Yeah.
But I hate learning new shit, too. I love to be smooth as a rock and just talk about shit I see that annoys me.
Yep. And I've gotten... no idea how to set up the next clip, but here we go.
Go ahead. For you. Read it. Read it.
Want to hear about this?
Yeah. You people that love the Russians,
you
listen
people.
To what they say about us. Go ahead.
This is not the Russians. This is the Swedes.
Same thing.
Peter Forsberg. Yeah, this is going to be great in the United Nations. We ought to be working there. Okay, from Stockholm in the papers, Kent Forsberg, head coach of Team Sweden, says Canada cheated its way against the Russians.
Same
Canada
before.
Did not earn the 2 points. Well, I'm just reading.
What are you
against
doing?
The Russians, I'm an objective journalist here.
Speak on it!
They didn't earn the 2 points. They got them from the referee. He went on to say we had a chance to have great propaganda with this tournament. Instead, the game of hockey will be the loser.
Thanks, Robert.
Top columnist in the second largest evening newspaper in Sweden went on to say we should change the name of this to the Canada coup d'etat. He says, about every fifth year or so, Canada forces the hockey world on its knees with weapons drawn and bank robbers' masks covering their faces. I watched
you
the
You European-loving people.
Hey, listen, just a second.
Okay, go ahead.
I just let that drag out for the phrase, you European-loving people.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
I still hold that he rules. I am the grapes defender.
Yeah. It's possible that we have developed some form of Stockholm syndrome regarding him at this point.
I get it. I've been there.
We are learning. We have learnt the entire Don Cherry lore in like 5 hours, which has been downloaded into us like that bit in The Fifth Element.
Yeah. Or in The Matrix, like, I know Don Cherry. Show me. Oh, this Matrix is good, actually. We like it here. The agents are a bunch of jerks.
I'm going to mention this before I forget it. You can watch a whole compilation of him butchering names. You've already seen part of it. He gets names, even Canadian names, like just Anglo names, wrong so fucking often. There was a person on Reddit that said he once said Yugoslavia. It's really good. So fucking good. There's a bit where like Don Cherry's like, oh, you went your vacation to Spain, and Ron McLean's like, no, Tokyo, and he's like, ah. It's really good. His butchering of names is a whole art form in itself, but I was like, we don't have time for it. But
where am I?
This man's xenophobia is I want each of you to try and finish the sentence, okay? This man's xenophobia is so authentic, so pure, that he managed to invent a slur for
the Welsh?
Russians? French Canadians?
So pure that he managed to invent a slur for Americans. Here we go.
That's good. As a Here country who has a slur for Americans.
Yeah.
I think this is more aggressive than Seppo. You tell me what you think. Here we go. And the context of this was like, so it's a very Canadian coded sport, but there's a lot of American cities participating in it. And there's teams that left Canada, and there's always this difficulty of like, can we get more? Anyway, here it is.
We invented the game in my hometown, Kingston, Ontario.
Not true.
We have the Hockey Hall of Fame. We put 75% of the players in the National Hockey League, and the Yankee Doody Dandles are telling us that we can't have a franchise.
The Yankee Doody Dandles.
Oh, that's their name now.
That's really good.
Yeah, I'm adopting that. That rules.
When it's Iraq wartime, he's pro-American.
Yeah.
When it's time for a little bit of Canadian jingoism, Yankee Doody Dandles.
Oh.
I was going to say before that, like, whilst I've been playfully saying how much I like him. If he was an Australian, I'd say he was the biggest cunt on earth.
Yeah.
But yeah, Yankee Doodle Dandles is great.
Yankee Doodle Dandles. Pretty good.
Again, and land sounds, of contrast.
Yeah.
And has kind of an Australian slant to it. It's kind of like sing-songy and uppy and playful. Like it's...
Yeah, I'm not mad at it.
Bring him here. Like, once he retires, like in Judge Dredd, when you stop being a judge, you have to go off into the desert. Like, he has to come here when he retires.
Well, yes, I know you want attention, Momo. So, to end the xenophobia section, perhaps nothing sums up his views better than this excerpt, which, again, is, I believe, in the context of Russians.
But listen, you kid, don't get caught in the Canadian syndrome, where if it's Canadian, it's got to be bad. We're the best. I've been telling you the best. How about the guy that used to be on it about 4 or 5 years ago? And you know those other, the amazing upper body strength of the Russians. So amazing. They're nothing. Just a minute.
No,
they're
sorry.
Nothing.
Tournament in Calgary.
O-T-H-I-N.
Had a
nothing.
Finish touch, but only one had a touching finish, and that was overseas, according to Don Cherry and the coaches.
Canada.
Wilson Hockey Night in Canada on CBC.
Number...
Before we get into anything, he slurs the word Canadian, so it sounds like it sounded to me like he said Cadian, which is a Warhammer reference. So there we go. This one for the episode,
or Acadian, which is a group of people that were kind of like genocidally deported from Atlanta, Canada. But that's another whole episode on its own.
These are Canadian players.
Yeah, it's. It's wild. And I just feel like that sums it up really well. And I wish I'd found a version of it where he got to finish his thing going number one, but it's YouTube. also I feel like his reference to like, remember that guy about 5 years ago? I think he's talking about Dave Hodge. Like he's just shitting on Dave Hodge, the guy who flipped his pen on the air.
Oh, he's nothing if not consistent.
Hmm.
True.
It's normally, I guess in Australia, you know, our media commentators, you know, they start off young and fresh or maybe like, you know, they are the same level of racism and value shift. But again, like it's still xenophobia, but it's weird to see it targeted against like other very white countries or like in a modern age would be considered very, very Caucasian. It's strange and, you know, like it's still bad, but like, oh, it's baffling. And also, again, there's this weird focus on bodies and physiques. And I don't. And again, we're dancing around, you know, trying not to make insinuations about like his preferences or like things he tends to hone in on. But the weird focus on like muscularity and body type is unusual.
Yeah, like at best, I mean, I feel like I might say like, when you live in a culture of repression, whatever it is that exists inside of you has to be filtered through certain things. And it just like, I don't have the expertise to say what is on his mind, but it feels like an interesting thing to be like, how would this person act? What would this person believe if they never felt pressure to act a certain way, be a certain way, think of a certain way?
No, that's
there's so many layers of societal repression occurring here that like you kind of go, has he done any introspection on it? Or has that just so simply been never an option that this is what is coming out instead?
Mm-hmm.
Like what does Don Cherry want from his life?
Well, let's get to this last section titled The End. Mm. Don Cherry's final televised broadcast occurred on November 9th, 2019.
No.
Before we get into it, I'd like you to take a wild guess at the circumstances in which his career finally came to a close.
They didn't renew his contract. I mean, I don't know. Like, did he do something like really fucked, or
did he drop his pants on stage, on camera?
Oh no, Kelly's smiling. What happened?
Well, yeah. Okay, I know this is a little different for you, but I will say the date is relevant. November 9th, 2019.
Is that, man. That's nearly, so November 11th is Remembrance Day in just like a lesser war celebration here. Is it significant in Canada?
Now, all you kids out there, if you guessed the woke moralists finally got to him, you'd be right. After decades of the pinko lefty government CBC keeping him on the air, he was finally brought down by the very factors that were cited as justifications for Rogers Sportsnet, private company, bringing him into their fold to begin with. Pragmatic business reasons. The ad executive I quoted earlier with that very explanation was a man named David Kincaid, who was interviewed because he was once a former senior marketing exec with the Labatt Brewing Company and credited with orchestrating a licensing deal between the brewery and the NHL back in the 1990s. Kincaid explained that society's, quote, evolution and social media and the ability to offer your opinion has changed the playing field. His brand has fallen out of relevance. End quote.
They didn't like that they were making remixes of him. Is that it?
The same Toronto Star article that I just quoted from also quotes a York University marketing professor who adds, especially for the beer companies, they're concerned with a younger group. This generation is far more sensitive to brand associations and values.
Oh, it was on that evening. Sponsorship deal. Shit.
November 9th, Don Cherry's latest on-air rant set off yet another round of public discourse, one that was overwhelmingly negative. So, let's roll the clip.
You know, I was talking to a veteran. I said, I'm not going to run the poppy thing anymore because what's the sense? I live in Mississauga. Nobody wears... very few people wear a poppy. Downtown Toronto, forget it, downtown Toronto, nobody wears a poppy. And I'm not going to wait. He says, wait a minute. How about running it for the people that buy them? Now, you go to the small cities, and you know those, the rows on rows, you people love, you that come here, whatever it is, you love our way of life, you love our milk and honey, at least you could pay a couple of bucks for poppies or something like that. These guys pay for your way of life that you enjoy in Canada. These guys paid the biggest price. Anyhow, I'm going to run it again for you great people and good Canadians that bought a poppy. I'm still going to run it. Anyhow,
love you for it.
Oh, God. Oh, it's so sad at the end. He kind of runs out of puff and he can't even fucking raise his thumb.
That's okay. So it's wild. So he was in favor of poppies and warm remembrance stuff.
Yeah, he's on the side of the, you know, the classic British joke. Where's your fucking poppy?
Yeah.
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 Oh, that's so much. Australia has had multiple people like lose their careers because they have suggested that maybe we're a little too horny for war.
Yeah. Mm.
So wow. The woke mob did get him.
Yeah, and I actually got really, really rabbit-holed into, there's a comment he makes somewhere about he has one of his grandfathers fought in the First World War, and here's a quote where he says, my grandpa fought at Vimy Ridge, and I was like, well, let's fact check that. So you had a whole episode about Gallipoli.
We did.
So imagine Gallipoli, but you won.
Oh.
Ah.
That's what Vimy Ridge is.
Right.
There's school named after it. It's a whole thing. Literally, like, word for word, the same phrase. Oh, that's when we forged an identity as a country.
Right, yep.
Same bullshit.
Gotcha.
Same thing. And it was very, this is like, it's not super relevant, but it was so wild where I was like, it should be pretty obvious. You look at some of the service record, were they there or they not? His grandpa, like, got shipped away from Vimy Ridge for medical reasons the day that the offensive started.
Ah, okay.
And
So I guess technically he wasn't Vimy Ridge.
Technically, and it was like, well, was the, and I don't think it was like a injury. I think it was like trench foot shit. But so it was like, oh, well, they left that day. They already had trench foot. They didn't fight. But then I was looking deeper and it was injured. Like, well, but there's not just battles. It's like you're stationed there. You might participate in probing attacks, which are life and death. You might have to defend against French attacks. And I was like, okay, this is silly. He's not doing stolen valor. His dad was there, or Sir Grandpa was there. It was just very, it was interesting to me how difficult it was to find an answer. Like, did they fight at Vimy Ridge? I don't know, because they were there and then they weren't. And it was like just the weirdest confluence of dates. But yeah, it doesn't really matter either way. He comes from this background where like family's the military, family is cops. And it's the same Anzac Day Gallipoli stuff where it's like people pay the ultimate price for British imperialism, but we don't talk about that part.
Yep, absolutely.
Wow, and to be clear, I want to talk about the suit he was, the jacket he was wearing. Was like double-breasted in 2019, big silver buttons, and then like this weird like fucking royal crest over the like over the heart, and then like the most like embellished looking poppy, like not one you buy at the shops. This one looked like a patch almost, like so it was a hell of a way to go out. But yeah, like there was. It's bizarre to, bizarre that this is what got him, being like, being too much of a sucking off the troops guy.
And the oddity part of it to me is that, so you can find that whole clip on YouTube. They do play the segment they had planned to roll out. The segment isn't bad. The segment itself is quite nice. He goes to like a young man's grave and says like, this guy died fighting in wherever. And like, if he just did that, it would have been fine. I would have played it if it weren't for the fact that I'm like, I'm cutting down for time. And also I just think he has not sold himself to this point. He's been a dick. And I'm like, I'm not going to play your poppy segment.
Yeah.
In a vacuum, the poppy segment is nice, but just this whole rant is very silly. And so I'll continue here. The writer of that Star article opines that that amid the social media backlash, it was the very same Labatt Brewing Company that finally did him in, by putting pressure on Sportsnet to finally do something about the tenured pundit. Quote, simply put, his angry on-air shtick was no longer worth the risk for sponsors such as Labatt, which shells out millions of dollars a year to have Budweiser front and center on their broadcasts. And without getting into a confusion of like Labatt, Budweiser, whatever, it's all the same insane conglomerate of beer, whatever. There's weird wrinkles to it, but it's not inconsistent. It's this company being like, suddenly bad for our sales. That writer went on to cite the company's statement on the matter, which I have lovingly overlaid on this Pride Month promotional image for Bud Light. And I'm going to read it in the most appropriate fucking executive ad copy voice imaginable. The comments made Saturday on Coach's Corner were clearly inappropriate and divisive, and in no way reflect Budweiser's views. As a sponsor of the broadcast, we immediately expressed our concern and respect the decision which was made by Sportsnet.
Right.
It's kind of sinister.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, we told them to remove this guy, and they did.
Well, I'm like, I don't know. We can maybe talk about this at the end, but I feel like the thing sucks, but I don't think it's the worst thing. To me, the sequence about the head injuries is the most like viscerally upsetting thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he wasn't fired for saying the worst thing he's ever said. He was fired for something that just tipped the hand of the sponsors.
Yeah.
Yeah. That also kind of doesn't have any real impact. You know, like the thing about like the worst thing is the stuff about the head injuries, like, that's an ongoing issue with the game and with the culture surrounding it, and like a thing that players are and former players are like working to improve. World War One was over 100 years ago.
Yeah, those people are dead no matter what.
Yeah.
So to be clear, what was the public the public response to this? Like, how did the audience respond? So, like, there was something of a backlash to, like,
yeah, media controversy.
To buy a poppy, like.
So the, yeah, so just like to kind of finish that what thing we were saying, like, there's, if you look at that exact clip of like the final episode, including the poppy thing, there's YouTube commenters being like, well, all he was saying was you should buy a poppy. It's the woke mob that canceled them. And a bit of me is like, was it that, or was it 40 years of bullshit that finally made people go enough? But I also like, I'm like, it almost does. Like, I think he should have been fired in 2011 for just the gratuitous defensive head injuries. Like, again, it's a job. You get fired from jobs for sucking your job. And he was a shitty analyst by that point. He should have been fired. And I'm glad he lost his job eventually, but it does feel like an anti-climax to lose it on this thing where I'm like, yeah, it sucks, but it, to me, is like the eighth worst thing he said.
And it is very sinister that it's because the sponsor felt it was the wrong direction.
Yeah. He didn't get fired by his bosses. He got fired by his bosses after his bosses heard enough from the sponsors.
Yeah. Like, so it's not even the channel making like coming down on an ethical choice. It's
right.
The money isn't going to follow him anymore.
Mm. And as I said before, the public broadcaster, the government broadcaster, never fired him. The private broadcaster, the theoretically more like morally bankrupt broadcaster, did fire him after they decided to tip their balance sheets. It's very bleak in my opinion.
But it also did seem a little bit like, as you said, the public were finally like what happened to Sam Newman in Australia. People were just like, okay, we've had enough of this guy. But yeah, still gross that it's, you know, just like balance sheets.
One of the things that really comes up in the reporting on this is Don Cherry was fired for his quote, "you people" rant. And you can easily see, he says this quick interjection, you come to this country and everyone latches on to, he made a racist rant against immigrants, which I'm not saying he didn't, but as we have seen, he said "you people" to refer to anyone that disagrees with him. And again, he does mention you come to this country, which is damning, but also he speaks so off the cuff. He changes thoughts mid-sentence constantly. And I don't want to hand it to him for plausible deniability, but it's also like, again, he said stuff to me that was so much more egregious that it feels like an anticlimax to take this thing and be like, now you're done. And it just really speaks to how marketing based and how like cynical the decision was. And again, I'm glad he was off the air, but it just like, it felt like it should have happened by that standard 5 times before this.
Yeah.
It's a bit Al Capone being done for tax fraud.
Yeah, totally.
So where is he now?
Well, let's get to that. So we talk about here about the decision made by Sportsnet. The decision, of course, was to finally fire Don Cherry. Sportsnet apologized. Ron McLean apologized. The NHL apologized. And Don, of course, refused to back down from his comments, saying, "I know what I said and I meant it. Everybody in Canada should wear a poppy to honor our fallen soldiers. I would have liked to continue doing Coach's Corner. The problem is, if I have to watch everything I say, it isn't Coach's Corner," which I think we can agree with. Coach's Corner has never been about him watching what he says.
Or watching hockey for the most part.
Yeah, you will notice this is not related to hockey.
That's true.
At all. "There is no shortage of discourse on the subject we could wade into, and an unfortunate amount of ink was spilled continuing to reach out to Cherry and others for comment."
Suit.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
No, I'm not even looking at the suit. I was just looking at his counterpoint on this. Tucker Carlson.
Yeah. Would you like to describe this for people that are only listening?
It's a screen cap of a Fox News segment, which is always bleak as hell. I'm going to let Lucas describe the suit in a second, because Lucas is on suit watch now. But Tucker Carlson is in frame, so it's the, was it called the Tucker Carlson Show? I don't know the name of the show.
Who cares?
But it's that terrible man, and he's making a face that does appear to be people without poppies sucked me off. Tucker looks horrified and disappointed, and Don is wearing a suit that Lucas is now going to describe.
The suit looks like a Highland dancer's skirt. It is like sort of plaid, sort of picnic blankety.
Do you mean a red, kilt, black, Lucas?
Kilty, yeah, I guess. I've forgotten how to speak. I am embodying Don. I am noticing he's not wearing a fucking poppy, and neither of them are wearing chins. I know that's stooping to Don Cherry's level. Tucker Carlson looks like a slug that has gained sentience. I know I shouldn't do this, but also like... But the expression is just going, but yeah, I'm guessing we're going to hear some shit now.
No, I have watched this clip. It's very boring. It sucks. Okay. And like I said, I didn't want to validate the amount of proverbial ink that was spilled. I just gave this screen grab because I'm like, I want to leave it out because I think we can all agree this is where the story really needs to end in the fall of 2019.
Why do they give a shit about... Why do Americans give a shit about Remembrance Day? They don't have it there. Was it a slow news day? No, they have...
Isn't it called Veterans Day?
Yeah, it's second to their Memorial Day, but I think that it's like... So Remembrance Day is a big enough deal in Canada, probably comparable to the UK. Mm. And with the... So Cherry was fired because he caused a stir of Remembrance Day. He was being a dick. And to me, he got a Tucker Carlson because he could just say I was canceled. That's what it is.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Welcome back once more from the future. So this clip is kind of going back to the origins of our story. It's going back into like Cherry's pre-broadcasting bio. But I wanted to kind of save it to the end for the listeners and viewers because after kind of seeing what we've seen, is this clip illustrative in some way to you? Do you feel like this kind of explains a little?
Don learned from his father too, Delmar Cherry. Delmar was a huge man, 6'2", 234 pounds, 17 and a half inch neck, 32 inch waist.
Yeah.
He could be explosive. He stood up to the toughest of the tough. And he loved his family.
My father was not a pal. My father never played games with us, and we were never pals together. He was the father. That's the way I think it should be.
Ooh,
Oh.
Instead of going to therapy, I got into hockey.
Yeah, I'm glad your brain formulated the same joke as mine was, because I was going somewhere in the direction of like men would literally have a 40-year broadcasting career and punch down on every possible vulnerable group rather than go to therapy.
Because like, okay, but like, have you ever seen the stuff that Andrew Tate says about his dad?
Yeah.
Vaguely like, familiar, yeah.
Yeah, it's the same kind of genre of like, my dad was incredibly strict, bordering on abusive, and you know, never did anything like fun with me. And that's good, actually. That turned me into the man I am today, as though that's a positive thing.
My dad had a screaming match with my mum because we got haircuts. Like, yeah, just like...
Yeah, that level
horrifying
of...
shit like that.
And he's like, it's good, actually. And you're like, oh, buddy.
Tell me you're traumatized without telling me you're traumatized.
Yeah. But I do like the idea that for both of them, it was a broadcasting career where they're like, I just need to tell it. I need to talk to people.
And it was good, actually. But like, yeah, the alternative is being, Jules, as you said on the Slap episode, like realizing you were victimized and you know, grieving the childhood you didn't have. And, you know, for a dude like that, that's just not going to fucking happen. So no.
Yeah, oh, Oh, the kind of, the almost sadness that he's, with which he says, my dad was never a pal, but it's the way it should be. I'm like, buddy.
Oh.
You just want to do the,
brutal.
It's not your fault. It's not your fault.
Yeah. I want to show that. I do want to do like a cruel thing where I take that clip and just show it to all my mates who are dads and make them cry.
Yeah, show. Actually, I support this because it involves telling people about this show and making them watch it. Be like, all right, I want you to watch all like 4 hours of this or however long it turns out.
Oh.
And
oh, no,
I am going to make.
I'm making everyone watch this. Absolutely. Like.
Oh, hell yeah. This is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So you show them the whole show and then you show them. I guess, I mean, it'll be partway through. But then you get to the moment of, oh, that's why. Mm. Yeah.
Mm. So he's Canada's hockey-based Andrew Tate.
Yeah, I guess so.
Hmm.
I mean, we hang a lot of shit on Don Cherry, but
he's not that bad.
Yeah. We don't have to hand it to Don Cherry, but I'm not going to call him Andrew Tate quite.
That's true. No,
there, yeah.
He loved at least one woman.
The low bar of not doing sex trafficking.
Yeah. And
he definitely loved
his wife. Yeah.
This is a clip that I actually had on the docket to put in the first cut. And because there's so much going on in this one. And because I didn't feel qualified to necessarily speak on it, I left it out. But I was like, you know, I can't put everything into the original. But you guys seem to engage with the material. And at the risk of tokenization, I feel like you can speak to this better than me, Jules. As a member of the queer community, what to make of this clip?
All right.
Are you guys ready to do for some intersectionality?
Oh, yes.
We're going to talk about the intersection of homophobia and europhobia.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. So we're going to have Bret Hart set this up for us by talking about a comedian named Scott Thompson, who you may have heard of. He was on Kids in the Hall, a fairly famous Canadian comedy group. So he's hosting some sort of show and Don Cherry is on it. And Scott Thompson is, I believe, an openly gay comedian. So for those keeping track, this is our second openly gay comedian palling around with Don Cherry.
Homophobic, just ask Scott Thompson.
And I think the reason the level of belligerence in the NHL is being brought down is the Europeans. The f***ing Europeans. And we're having the exact same problem.
Well, you should know.
I do, Don. Listen to this. And we're having the exact same problem in the gay community right now. Whenever a brawl breaks out in a bar, all the Europeans are in the corner saying, don't hit me, don't hit me.
So when they say don't hit you, so when the in the corner say don't hit them, what do you do to them?
You kiss them.
I know.
Mate.
He just wants a cuddle. He just wants a cuddle from another man.
Yeah.
Like, he wants, yeah.
And one of the reasons I wanted to come back to this.
Physical affection.
Yeah. One of the reasons I wanted to come back to this clip was that after having gone through all of it with you, I remembered as he's cuddling this comedian, the explanation that he kind of gave earlier of how, like, you're allowed to do this, I guess, queer-tinged stuff if you're a tough guy.
Mm.
If you're not a tough guy, then it's weird. But because he's a character of tough guy, he's allowed to do it. And I feel like this completely tracks with that. Is one place he's being very consistent. It's like, because everyone knows I'm the straightest, toughest man in the world, I can cuddle the gay comedian. But if Ron McLean did, it'd be weird.
There's definitely something in that. Like there's definitely in Australia, there are a kind of straight guy. I'm always a little bit like, are you though? Like, it's okay. There's nothing wrong with it, but like, where like there's hardcore masculinity is so deeply homoerotic. I'm pretty sure I said that on like one of the episodes, or it might have been our Matilda's episode, but like it's so gay.
Yeah.
Sports is gay. like, competition is gay. Deep masculine physicality is really gay. And, like, and I think also, like, there's this thing of he's so excited to be able to say f***.
Yeah, I didn't tell them that I didn't take time to bleep
that's
these
okay.
before. I'll bleep them after, but, you know. They'll bleep the final product, probably. But yeah, you could see he gives him the pass and then he says it.
Yeah.
And it's like,
yeah.
I was like, I don't know how to feel about this, but like, I'm sure somebody could have some insight on this.
I'm a Slur's illegal person in that definitely I feel like Don Cherry doesn't necessarily get a pass, but I'm very firmly with the, like, if it's ever been yelled at you out of a car window, you get to use that word.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, and within the queer community, there's like, you could kind of really tell who actually hangs out with other queers and whose queer experience is entirely online, because all the people who actually hang out with other queers will just use slurs at the drop of the hat, like affectionately for each other. I was at a rally a couple of weeks ago, and I ran into a mate of mine who introduced me to their friend as, "This is Jules, one of the local f***s." Mm-hmm. And I was like, fair enough.
But also, like, if I can jump in and guess here, like, these, when, like, because I would never hang Shane and Scott Thompson for saying it, but, like, the story you're telling is, like, we're in the circle.
Yeah,
this is a safe space,
yeah.
We're going to use it. Versus saying it in front of the bigot on public television. It's like,
you're kind of setting him up, and should you have done that?
Mm.
Yeah, see, like, that's where I'm not really shocked, because I'm like, oh, we definitely use the language in the queer spaces, but outside those spaces, it's sort of like, yeah, it is that, like, we might be giving other people a pass to do it who aren't really fully in the ally tent. And and it's also sort of the way that people talk about their families, where you can hack shit on your own family members, but other people can't do it, and you might not do it around other people as much. And that's sort of what it feels like to me. It's like if that was an entirely queer setting, talking about, like, Euro guys, everyone would be like, yeah, we love making fun of all the kinds of gay.
I was thinking, like, there's a core,
like,
of a good
the
joke there.
Yeah.
Like, especially if you're making, if you're riffing on Don Cherry, if you're acknowledging that he's kind of this weird, like, xenophobic bigot, like, there's a good, like, stand-up or joke premise there of, like, oh, yeah, this is the problem in Canadian gay bars. When a fight breaks out, all the Euro gays want to hide in the corner. Like, you're riffing on Don's ideas and applying it to something else. To me, like, that there's the mechanics of that joke are very funny, but it's like the situation around it of, like, you're doing this joke with him instead of at him. It adds all these layers of, like, well, now I'm not sure how I feel about this whole thing. It's just so weird. We're going to do a real quick drop. I kind of wish I touched on this more, cuz it's just, like, a really funny just, like, a funny footnote to it. But we talked about, you know, the French Canadian kind of xenophobia, and, you know, how he would get in trouble for this, and it's all cyclical. What I should have mentioned is, on multiple occasions, I think most of the times Cherry said anything shitty about French Canadians, it was not just that there was, like, some sort of public outrage. It would be, like, a French Canadian MP publicly complaining about it in the House of Commons. Like, Don Cherry regularly came up in the House of Commons. I don't know if there's parallels to that in other countries, but yeah, this was for sure a thing that happened a solid, like, three times for, I don't know. We'll have to compile them later, but.
I can't think of anything like that that's come up in Australian politics that much.
All right, well, please enjoy this
part. Yeah, that's beautiful.
Don Cherry tient des propos méprisants et voire racistes.
He should be ashamed of himself.
So for those who don't speak French, if you don't know what Don Cherry and racist mean.
Oh.
Now you can figure it out.
Was he being racist against French Canadians?
Oh,
again?
Surely. I don't even know the context of that one. It was, again, just quickly snipped from. Again, this is in, that clip was from the episode where you're supposed to be, you take you 45 minutes to sell Don Cherry as the greatest Canadian, and you spend 30 minutes of it being like, here's what people say sucks about him. Because that's where that came from. And like they just spend so much time on, it's the same with, what was the other clip with the thing about like him talking about how like his dad didn't play with him. That is part of what they edited down into the best 45 minutes of like, this man is the greatest.
Oh, his dad didn't love him. Oh, yeah.
His dad didn't love him and he hates the French.
I'm sure, you know what? The both things can probably be said of Johnny McDonald. So as I kind of explained at the beginning, I was trying to find old clips of George Strombolopoulos' show, The Hour, so I could find him doing the catchphrase. So I went on YouTube and I sorted by date and I scrolled to the bottom. And I was quite shocked by what I found for the oldest clip of The Hour on YouTube. And we're going to watch the intro here.
Yeah, last week, Tucker Carlson called Canadians mentally if we can figure out how to use the phone to call him, then he'll be on the show tonight. This is The Hour.
So, we have dropped this in after the freeze frame of my very quick mention of Don Cherry going in Tucker Carlson's show, because I thought this is not about Tucker Carlson. He's American. We don't care. This is not relevant to our story. And that's why I kind of got jump scared by finding the oldest possible clip I could of Strombo.
Oh,
and who
boy.
Is he talking about?
It's all coming together.
Yep.
And once again, it's like, hey, there was a time that you really could just say that on TV. Just give her.
It was just out there, yeah.
I will admit that this, again, has nothing to do with Don Cherry, but it was just another connection I didn't expect where, to fill you in on a bit of stuff that I kind of, I'm editing in the edit that doesn't, I didn't bring back to you. I just, quick asides of things I noticed where, as I'm sort of mounting this little narrative, it's like, oh, another person we mentioned, Avril Lavigne. Well, she's also been seen with George Strombolopoulos. I'm going to just kind of pepper these in. I never expected to ask myself the question, has Tucker Carlson appeared on George Strombolopoulos' show? And there's only one way to find out, and that's to hit play.
That's something obviously we downloaded off the internet. That's him on tape. Let's go now where he is in Jersey. Tucker, it's nice to have you on the program. When I first heard this, my first thought was,
thanks, George.
This is a cry for help. But is ridiculous. I expected something a little more clever than the
No. Wait, though. I mean, take it back. I mean, not to split hairs with you, George, but take it back to the tape. I didn't say that Canadians were I don't think they are.
Well, we're like
Wednesday, I play squash with a Canadian who's, yeah, right. I mean, they're like someone you have affection for, but whose opinion you don't often hear, and whose opinion, frankly, you don't take all that seriously. But, it was not meant with any malice at all.
I know you got smoked by a lot of Canadians in terms of your email from your comments. You have to understand one thing, and one thing clear, we're not afraid of taking criticism. You just got to be smarter than saying, okay? That just be a little bit more.
No,
than
but
that.
I wasn't calling you guys. I must say, can I say one thing?
Yes.
The Canadian people email a lot.
I have edited this down.
Charlie, can you confirm this?
Like he goes on to really talk about how much Canadians love email. So yeah, we love email. It's our favorite.
Really?
No, I hate it.
Okay.
But I hate all technology.
Is it like a cultural kind of
this is just Tucker Carlson saying shit.
Okay. I was just wondering if it was like a letters to the editor kind of thing, but from a whole country.
I mean, like that is the point Tucker Carlson is making.
Mm.
And weirdly enough, like this is just another kind of topic that we can get into someday, but like he's kind of making salient criticisms of how like Canadian identity is rooted in anti-Americanism, at least at this time, which is like 2005.
Mm.
And he does point out that like when we say shit, like Canadians in particular love to email and express their displeasure with me, Tucker Carlson. Yeah.
I mean, I'm I'm pretty sure a lot of people have expressed displeasure with Tucker Carlson. Mm-hmm.
Well, it really shows you, again, how of its time this is, where I think I cut this part out, but when he's setting up the interview, he has to explain who Tucker Carlson is, which is not a thing you really have to do anymore. So that's all we have for video clips. I have two more still images. So this is a story that came out in May of 2022.
I love the idea of him, his writing always being in all caps.
Yeah.
But yeah, there's a real energy to this of like, friendship ended with Ron McLean. Now Tucker Carlson is my best friend.
Oh my God.
I can't remember. Did we go into why they stopped being friends?
The kind of fallout was that Cherry felt that because he was fired and nobody at the CBC stuck up for him, he felt betrayed, especially by his longtime co-host and, you know, enabler, my word. You know, Ron McLean apologized for Cherry's comments after the fact, even though he didn't push back in the moment.
Yeah.
And which I think you can fairly view as a bit hypocritical, but he definitely felt betrayed and said he would never talk to Ron McLean again.
Mm.
But we would never end the episode on a bummer, which is why we're going to have a happy ending with this news story from September of 2023.
Yay!
They do love each other.
That actually makes me weirdly happy. I like it when the old men have a friendship. It's healthy for them.
You could argue they kind of deserve each other a little bit, and it means we're possibly going to get more like Ron McLean faces.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think Don is coming back to TV, but I kind of alluded to being like a kind of soft Don Cherry defender several years ago, and I was a soft Ron McLean defender a lot more recently. But after sitting and poring through all this, this whole project has really lessened my view of Ron McLean as a guy who's just a total enabler. And I made fun of this, made fun of him for this before, but I will do it again. Like, he was neutral on the Iraq War. And I feel like that is so emblematic of who Ron McLean is, that like, he is the living embodiment of, I think, that the quote from, was it Desmond Tutu, of like, if you're neutral in situations of injustice, you've chosen the side of the oppressor, right?
Yeah.
If you're neutral in situations of homophobia, xenophobia, I guess he pushed back on misogyny and fairness, but like, then you have taken the side of Don Cherry. And like, you don't get to separate yourself from it because you cheered it on the whole time because that was your paycheck and that was your...
Yeah. Like, there's something almost to be said for, like, at least Don Cherry says it with his whole chest.
That's how I feel about the Iraq War thing, is like, it's one thing to be a warmonger and a fascist and an asshole. You know, it's to say what you will about National Socialism, at least it's an ethos where like, somehow,
no one snip this.
Yeah. If somebody is pro Iraq War or pro whatever terrible invasion, then like, you have a bad opinion, but you've reached it through some sort of belief system or thought. To be neutral in the Iraq War, it's like, you don't get to be neutral. If you're neutral, you're pro. Like, either you believe this is absolutely unacceptable and should be condemned, or you're for it. Like, that's not really middle ground to me.
100%. Absolutely.
Also, the basis of their whole broadcast is, you know, Don Cherry says something whack as shit, and Ron McLean, like, winces, pulls a funny face, and sort of like softens it a little bit by being just like, now wait, Don. So yeah, he absolutely, you're right in calling him an enabler in that regard.
So he never attempted any kind of comeback to the medium of television, which means there is just the one elephant in the room to address. And I know you're both just burning to ask the question that's on everyone's mind.
Is it about George?
The question is, did he start a weekly podcast?
Oh my God.
I wish your video was on for that, honestly.
Oh.
The answer, of course, is a resounding yes. As of this recording, is it at 222 episodes and going strong? 247 and counting.
Oh, it's so many.
Oh my God.
I haven't listened to it. That was another thing. I'm like, this thing has already gone too long. Yeah. As you know, we have spent several hours talking about this.
So
how long is each episode?
They're like 20 minutes. They're very short. I think somebody smart is putting them together for him. And at some point I might dig into it just to see if anything's interesting is happening. But like I said, for every minute of controversy, it's like hours of just banality. And I just don't care enough to really look into the things that much. He's probably just vaguely ranting like an old man. And again, his ostensibly worst thing was saying, "Where fucking Poppy?" And you look at the level of like conservative and far right discourse around here, there's so much worse going on out there. So I don't really give a shit that he's making a podcast. Like, whatever.
Yeah.
He did not come back to TV, and that is something.
Is it a video podcast?
I don't think so, no. Oh. It's on my podcast app. I haven't looked at the video podcast.
So there's no suits.
We just have to imagine the suits.
No, and again, the guy's like 90 years old or something.
Yeah.
Oh, he must be so fucking old.
So like, I think getting him to sit down and talk, right? Yeah. And it's just like, all right, he wants to talk for 20 minutes. And like, I looked at the episode titles. He's probably just talking hockey shit. I don't really care. What I cared about was ending it on a good note. So one and an upbeat note, and I've saved the most fun clips for last. First, you may have noticed some of the footage. This was pointed out that we've watched that our boy here likes to gesticulate a lot when he talks.
Mm-hmm.
Someone clever also noticed this and produced one of my all-time favorite videos ever, Don Cherry's Piano Desk. Here we go.
How about Randy Cunningworth? Come on, you're supposed to be running this thing,
great.
Come on. Smart enough.
What do you think
you're
of Randy Cunningworth?
You're not going to get your Emmy this year. Randy Cunningworth was one of the guys, many great coaches in Rochester.
I'm very sorry for the audio list. You just have to look it up.
And I hope he has success like most of them.
Oh my God.
I'm not getting my award and you're getting your award for this. I see. I understand. Okay.
Anytime he pats or touches the desk, it makes piano noises.
I cheer for Toronto Maple Leafs ever since I was a little bored. You know, the Quaker Oats beehive and all that. But there's another reason, too. Let's be honest. If they were in the playoffs, our ratings would go wacko. And when I see a team that has 3 years in a row is the worst team killing penalties, there's something wrong somewhere. Now, I'm not going to mention his name because I think that's the reason. He's down in the minors right now, their minor team. He has them second in the league killing penalties.
I can imagine they just basically had like a mirror in this video or something and just a mirror version of this video and just mirrored his hand movements and smashed a piano.
And recorded it.
That's a brilliant idea.
He leaves and he's 30th in the league with different players and everything. And to have him not up here.
Aren't they 29th? But anyway, maybe.
No, they're the 30th. I said they're 30th or 30th. It's either one thing. I don't think I'm this important. Either I kill the kid, tell him to come up, or they're stupid. What do you think?
Well, I do think they were right about Roberto Lombardo. He was sensational net off.
Remember when everybody was giving him heck and saying booing him and all that? They weren't saying, Lou, I said, give him a chance. Well, he gets a few saves. He's going to be the best in the league again. Well, at the end of the game, we'll show it. He's playing very good.
What was the story of the prospects game when Eric Gudbranson couldn't come and play for you?
No, he should be the number one Canadian. You know, cool. Yeah. Kiefer Sutherland's 24 man's grandpa. Like, he seemed pretty cool. But no, my boy Don, he's my boy Grace is the best Canadian.
Yeah.
I think
Don Cherry in his late career ran a fine line between being too ridiculous and easy to dunk on for the internet. And that can be something you can tap into to make yourself more popular, get more attention. But I think he fucked it up. I think he was a bit too easy to make fun of, too easy to be an old man, you know, just a grouchy old fuckhead. Because he had that Donald Trump energy of like being just a sassy wanker. But I don't know. He just lacked that final ingredient to sort of, you know, exploit that to gain power. And I reckon that was part of why the advertisers dumped him. It's just like, nah, this guy's too easy to dunk on.
I think from the moment he was on a private Rogers contract versus a public CBC contract in 2014, he always had the sword of Damocles hanging above him.
and he didn't, there's no such thing. I joked about it being tenured, but there was such a thing as tenure. He's not a public broadcaster. And it was the, I think his bosses from the moment they signed him were just going to watch the numbers every year and be ready to dump him the moment it would, he was no longer convenient to them. And the moment there was a big enough outrage, they went gone. And it just, but that, I think that rant really pales in comparison with his body of work about women, about Native people, about concussions. Like, it's just not, it really does pale in comparison, I think.
It sucks that that's what did him in, even though I am now his biggest fan. In all seriousness, he seems like a real piece of shit. He's one of those media personalities you look at and you're just like, how the fuck is no one? I'm willing to bet. Do you know anyone in your day-to-day life who legitimately enjoyed his work? Like, on a
day-to-day, no. I mean, barely anyone in my day-to-day life. Again, I hang out with fucking weirdo hippies. Like, no one I know even likes hockey. So when I do go interact with hockey people, and like, I had to turn down an invitation to go play hockey tonight to do this podcast, and it was like, hey, can you come play? And I was like, no, I gotta do
my video essay.
I gotta do something cool. Like, I hear the same fucking climate change opinions from them. So like, but like, I don't know. Like, even like I kind of threw a little shade at my parents here. Like, my dad, who's a very like, I guess, libertarian kind of guy, who's like, again, maybe this is because he's from Alberta and Don Cherry's from Ontario, but he always thought Don Cherry was like a stupid TV clown. So like, like, it's not just advertisers. Popular opinion did shift. And I think, like, you know, I got a lot of my mid-2010s engagement with the sport from Reddit. And everyone on Reddit was, which is like a pretty centrist website, is like, this dude is so dumb, like, we don't give a shit, he's such a dinosaur. Like, that was the vibe for a while, but you can go to YouTube comments and see people still defending him. So it really is just like, where are you going and who are you talking to?
But it is also a case of like, the sort of people who post comments on YouTube are the dumbest fucks on earth, but
but there's enough of them out there. So
yeah, So I don't know. It's an interesting parallel to Australia, where we have media personalities who are in sport and they just persist even though no one likes them. So eventually it's just, I don't know, just one day an advertiser gets like cheesed off and it's just like, yeah, we got rid of, you know, guy who has been saying stupid shit for years, like guy who's been doing horrible shit for years. And this is finally what got him. It's like Jules said, like Al Capone getting done for you know, tax fraud.
And there's a great question. I think it's true in a lot of sports, of like, why are sports personalities so tenured? Like, in many places, like, if your players just don't like you, if they feel you're not doing your job adequately, you just lose your job. Like, even in hockey, even in the world of these very privileged people, if you are a head coach, you will be fired if the team just isn't doing very well. It's no big deal to fire a coach, but to like fire a broadcaster is somehow like, again, everyone is tenured for no reason, and it's not just him.
You know, I have memories of Australian sports journos talking about the cricket while I was growing up in, like, long car drives. I don't care about cricket, but, like, there's still the smallest emotional response to the name Richie Benaud. And in a culture where sport holds, I would say, an unreasonable status. There's some form of like prophet and priest king.
All right. I would love to comment more, but let's hit the end here. So to take it full circle, I did mention in the beginning that I was forced to read some of the quotes in this piece in my own voice because I can't do a Don Cherry impression. But you know who can? Is erstwhile NHL star PK Subban seen here entertaining a certain TV heartthrob you may recognize?
Goes out here. Now look at this. He goes out here. You can't, you do that. And I'm telling you, back in the day when we had Samenko and these guys, they took care of that stuff. PK, he's a good player. I mean, he's no Bobby Orr. He's a good player. Isn't that good?
And George is there.
George stole above us.
George!
That's right. That's right. That's basically all I have for you today.
Yay!
Only like thank 18 you. Hours of it.
Yeah.
We were here a while, but look, that was such a journey. The fact that you managed to tie it off there is beautiful.
Mm. There was just so much. I was just so hard not to dive into everything. There's so much.
That was wonderful. It must be like midnight there.
Fine for me. I have infinite energy for stupid shit.
Okay, good.
Do you want to do your plugs? You know what? Each of you took a turn. I'll do a turn. You should listen to Australian Gothic. It is a podcast about all of the good, bad, ugly versions of Australian culture, why it's fucked, what's fun about it, and really just how colonial cultures are just very colonial, which I think is very relevant.
Thank you for doing it better than either of us could. That was wonderful. Thank you. Well, giving us this treat of like Canadian hero, now Australian hero, Don Cherry.
Yeah, it was a bit of a journey. And
it was
you can also
wonderful.
Check out you I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Thank you so
even
much.
Even though
Kelly.
Your headphones didn't.
Yeah, my headphones cut out. And also tragically, a little while after my headphones cut out, my cat woke up from where he was sleeping on the bed and came and like purred on my lap for a bit and then was a dickhead and I had to kick him out. So there might be some weird noises coming through on my recording for that bit, but that's what that was.
Yeah, I thought I heard like a baby noise. It was a cat.
It was a cat. Yeah. I am not Grimes. I do not have a secret baby stashed somewhere in my house.
Okay, for a second I was just like, what the fuck, is that my kid? They're not here.
No,
like,
no it's my kid.
I'm home alone, what the fuck? Mm.
Well, it's and dumb. you can also check out Born Our Punches at blah, blah, blah. We've talked about it in 2 episodes. Mm. That's the end. I do have one last little treat to play as an outro.
Yes.
We don't have to comment. We can just let it ride. It's up to
all
you.
Right.
There's a really brief mention on Don Cherry's Wikipedia page. It's not even properly cited, and it reads as follows. In 1992, Cherry lent his voice to the charity song Rock'em Sock'em Techno for Canadian techno group BKS. And when I read this, I'm like, okay, yeah, like someone said, can we use a sample of you going like, let's go? And he said, yes. And I'm like, that's what it is, right?
Tell me it's the entire song.
I'm just going to play us out. I now present you this without further comment.
They let the man rap.
Let's go! Listen, never turtle. You do that, they call you Myrtle. Let's go! Let's go!
Born Under Punches is recorded primarily in Amiskwitsiwaskoykan, in the traditional territory of the Nahiyuwak, Nakota, Nitsitapi, Nakawe, Métis, and other nations, also known as Edmonton, Alberta, in Western Treaty 6 territory.
He could dangle, he could score. Who else, Bobby Orr? Let's go! Let's go! Who's the best? I often ponder. Right now, it's CV Wonder. Let's go! Let's go!
It was presented this week by me, Kelly Gomo, as well as Jules and Lucas from Australian Gothic. Once again, a breakdown of sources used can be found in the description.
Drop them! Let's tangle! Beauty! Let's go!
If you enjoyed this mini-series and have suggestions on something you'd like to see next, hit us up on social media or join our Discord. All those can be found in our Linktree page, also in the description for your convenience.
Blue, blue, what a pup! Oh, how she loves the Stanley Cup! Hockey man is what I am! Let's go! Listen to what I say! Play that game the Canadian way! Hockey man is what I am!
I don't know. Didn't have a proto age gap or something like
that. Well, he was definitely an adult. Alright. Hold on. I know I wrote down birth years in here. And we'll edit this out. Thanks for listening, and happy trails to you.